everybody. All right, there we go. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of our Shower Reviews, our last show of the year. Very excited for this episode. I got my my co-hosts, two of them here. I got Stu on my left. Stu, God, I'm sorry, Stu. You will not answer unless I say your full name. I got Big League Stu on my left.
Thank you.
He was going to sit there not saying it. And I got Mark. And he's the same way as you want. I got Snarky Mark.
Yeah.
Yeah, see? Snarky Mark in front of me.
No nickname Drell.
No nickname Drell. And we are missing, again, in action, Melissa the Millennial. But that's all right. Now we can have adult conversations.
Yeah. Stop.
Talking with little kids here and shit.
At the kids' table.
Yes. We're at the grown-ups area now. Now, this show, in case it's your first time watching, we talk about music that came out the past weeks and review them. We also have some drinks on hand. I have a special game for everybody today for the shots we're going to be doing. And for the holidays, we are drinking some eggnog that we found in the store that we didn't have to actually mix together with rum. It comes with rum, brandy, and whiskey already blended in. So would you like a glass too, Mark?
Pennsylvania
Dutch.
Do you
like eggnog at all?
I've never really done eggnog.
I've only had it without the... Without the spike in it, but this is my first time with the spike.
I've had both kinds.
What would you say?
I've never bought pre-made. I've only had made my own.
Uh-huh.
Have and you tried it yet?
I'm trying it right now as I take another sip in. If you never had eggnog, it's kind of I can't really describe it to you, but it tastes like eggnog.
It's cream.
Yeah.
It's cream liqueur.
It tastes like eggnog, but it's got like alcohol in it.
Low.
There we go. Oh, yeah, that's right. Sorry about that. We're recording now, but I'll have to... No, I can just bring this down. There we go. I forgot one thing. Doing all this stuff. Now you can definitely hear us. Once again, this is Jarrell. No name Jarrell, and I got to my left... I'm a no nicknames Jarrell. We got Stu on my left. Big League Stu.
Yep.
And we got Snarky Mark.
That's me.
There we go. Now
I'm sure they still heard us.
Yeah, but it was kind of low. And I'm like, why is it so low? As I was turning it up a bit. All right, so today we'll be reviewing the new album from... We got Kid Cudi, had an album that came out a couple weeks ago. New album from Chris Brown, we'll be doing that album. And we'll be doing a new album from Caged Elephant. And since it's the last show of the year, we'll be giving you our top 10 lists of the best albums we heard in 2015, which each one of us had our own personal picks of what we have in there. And I think you all be surprised at what my number one album will be.
MC Lars.
Damn it, you ruined it, Stu. And also, as I teased before, we're going to be doing some drinks, some shots here. And I want to say this is a little bit different. Normally, we have a special drink that we do shots of. But this time, I have all these shot glasses you guys are looking at that are poured for us.
Yeah, and this looks very intimidating.
This game we're going to play today is called Shot Roulette or Vodka Roulette. So all these have different ones have vodka in it, and some have water straight from the toilet.
I'm kidding.
The vodka which is a...
Okay, now it's not as intimidating. Some of them are water.
Some of them are water and some of them aren't. And the vodka I got is a brand called, because I like ska music, I got this brand called Major Ska.
Major Ska.
That's what it says. Major Ska. Which, one thing that makes this great, two things. One is ska, which is great. You'll be dancing and skanking all night. And two is only $9.
Yeah.
With the
Don't mess with Major Ska. Make you do push-ups.
They'll make you pick
skank
it up.
Skank it style. Yeah. Pick it up.
Pick up the vomit. It's got 40% alcohol volume, so that's pretty good, right? You guys want to join in? Is it good? Yes? You're excited for the Major Ska? It's Major Ska.
So what game do we play in order to get, like, Lil Jon has no part in this then?
Well, Lil Jon is our mascot. He tells us when it's time to do shots. So how do you actually want to play this, Lil Jon? Should we have, like, I spin a roulette wheel around, or what should we do with it, actually?
I think every shot we grab one.
Yeah, what do you think, Lil Jon? I think he agrees. So this is how it works. You just grab one and drink it. But we'll toast to it. Everybody! Can't smell it either. It's cheating. Just got a down the hat. Everybody! All right, to a great year,
mystery,
you guys.
Mystery shot.
Mystery shots. Let's see
who
what we got here.
Shot?
Water.
Vodka.
Vodka.
Maybe it was vodka.
Well, would you know, right?
Do you have anything here?
Is that even? I don't know. Is it even water? Who knows? We'll find out.
Like, do you have?
He needs a chaser.
Oh wait. Okay. Yeah. Do you want some?
That. You chase. Yeah, chase
some more vodka.
Chase with more vodka.
Do you want some eggnog with that?
I guess so.
No. I'll get you them. But if you want to check Stu in that closet right there, that's where I get the actual water from. Which I'll sponsor the water as well. The water is from Poland Spring, I believe. No, wait. Sorry. No. I'm sorry, Poland Spring. It's actually the no-name brand from Stop and Shop, but they have a
name. Arcadia City Water.
Yes. Yeah. The finest water. No, how would
it does say spring water.
Yeah. So was it good for you, Stu?
Yeah, it was very tasty spring water.
Would you like some eggnog before we get the show started?
Yes, I want some.
Okay, let me pour you some as you do a commercial for
Buttery Goose milk.
I'll pour two drinks while you do a commercial for the water.
Oh, let's see. Protected Springs. Whitehaven, PA. Molly'stown, PA. Tower City, PA. Battle Creek, PA. West Penn, PA. Penn Grove. I guess it's...
This is the best commercial I've ever heard.
It's all kinds of water from Pennsylvania.
Nice. And as you can see, you didn't buy enough eggnog. We're almost out of it. But...
Because you drank all of it.
I pour everyone the same amount. That's just three right there.
You're not supposed to drink a lot of eggnog anyway.
I find this real questionable.
It's definitely not semen, I'll tell you that right now. So, for the Halloween holiday spirit, you guys, let me check my notes. How was your Christmases? You guys get everything you wanted?
Christmas Eye?
Yeah. You get everything you wanted, Stu, from Santa Claus?
Yeah, yes, I did.
Like what? Video game cartridges? And...
Yes, I got a video game.
And... I did too, actually. Real quick, one thing I got was I got a Nintendo cartridge flask. So it's like, it looks just like a Nintendo cartridge from the 80s, but you put your alcohol in it, and instead of being called Duck Hunt, it's called Drunk Hunt.
Nice.
Only thing it looked weird walking around the city pulling out a Nintendo cartridge every time to sip it. It's not something you can be discreet with, but it is cool nonetheless.
Yeah, I got Zelda. Triforce Heroes.
Uh-huh.
Wanted the new Zelda.
For what console?
3DS. I got to play every Zelda.
Or else what? You turn to stone or something? You got to play it all by midnight?
I just play everyone. Try to collect them all.
Got to collect them all! So, like, Zelda, actually, I hated that game as a kid. Where you, really? Come at me if you want. I don't give a shit, but...
I'll pop off.
But I never got into RPGs. From that to, like, Zelda...
It's like an action RPG, though. It's not necessarily a total RPG.
Yeah, you're right. It's just kind of like... You're just going... There's no, like, 2D board just going from one to the other. I couldn't get into that as a kid. I always liked the two-dimensional, go straight from here to there, Mario style, Sonic the Hedgehog.
Oh, so you liked Castlevania Simon's Quest?
I liked Metroid. I like Metroid. I liked all that stuff. As we get geeky as hell on this podcast, yes. Everyone out there listening, bear with us.
Simon's Quest was like the worst Castlevania. It's the worst. But it was an RPG that side-scrolled.
Yeah.
I like the side-scroll. Like, it's cool.
Don't go outside at night because there's just fucking zombies that you can't kill and they just destroy you every time. Yeah. It's the worst.
So how about you, Mark? What did you get for Christmas?
I got some good stuff. I got a couple movies, a couple books.
Like paper books? Like you have to turn the page yourself? Wow, yeah. Mark is old school.
A couple books.
Mark's such a hipster. I got a typewriter, too.
Getting clothes.
Got yourself a rotary phone.
My mom got me two shirts.
Yeah, I got some clothing.
Yeah, and I got Super Mario Maker for the Wii U.
So Wii U, is that worth it compared to just the regular Wii? Regular Wii?
Well, it's definitely, I mean, it looks better.
Yeah,
you can play Wii games on it.
How long should
you don't have to turn your TV on?
What?
Can't you just play it right from the small handheld?
No, that's just a controller. Like
I thought, you could play certain games from the controller.
Games you can. Like what the hell game was it that I was playing? Oh, that's the cool. Yeah, Wind Waker. Because like I got the version that comes with Wind Waker, Zelda Wind Waker,
right.
Built into it, the HD version, and with that, you can push the button, and then you can just play it on the handheld.
Yeah,
which is cool.
Awesome.
But not all games do that.
All right. Cool. Well, really cool. I mean, really happy that you got what you wanted.
Yeah.
Is it everything? Do you bother making a list, do you guys, or do you just like?
I made like an Amazon list, best? Mostly because my girlfriend's family, they do like a Secret Santa because there's so many people in their family. They just like do a this, that.
Yeah, you don't have to buy it from everybody. Just everybody gets a present from somebody.
But yeah, so I had to at least give people an idea of what I wanted.
Yeah.
And that's books. Where I got books from.
Yeah.
That's right, literally. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, our first sneeze.
God bless you.
Our first show sneeze.
Really? You ever seen that show before?
No, I don't think I've
ever seen it. All right, we gotta put that in the notes. Make sure I put that on this episode, Stu sneezes.
Make sure you check the time code for the best.
Yeah, I want to timestamp that too, because we want to know when that exactly happens. All right, so what I got beside the flask, because I got some CDs that will be on my top 10 list, and I got a mobile adapter, which would be great. When I do my interviews, I can also upload them to the thing right away instead of having it drain my battery. So that was a nice gift from Clint. I want to thank you for that. Real quick plug, speaking of interviews, next week is the big show, or this Saturday, the big show at the Seacos in Raritan with the Chernobyl Disaster. It's not actually playing that show, but a cover band called Buddha from the Dude Ranch, which they're actually doing like a Blink-182 cover band, and also other bands playing there too. Free to get in. Show starts at 9 o'clock. Get there early. Get all the drinks you want. Stay all the way till closing time.
Cheesesteaks are good.
You'll definitely have a great time with that. And we actually record there once in a while there too, so I'm thinking of telling you guys we actually might record there towards the end of January. But more details on that later. Back to Christmas. I usually watch Christmas movies like every year, like my anti-Christmas movie, like Die Hard and fucking Gremlins, shit like that. I saw a movie last year called P2, which is like about a girl getting trapped in like these things.
The
and it actually takes place during Christmas, and it's got the guy from American Beauty in it as the psycho like security guard. Not that great of a movie, but it falls in the lines of Christmas. Basically, and if it takes place in December, it falls on my list.
You gotta see Krampus.
I fucking slacked this year. I didn't get to see a lot of Christmas movies, but I did catch...
see Krampus.
I did catch three movies.
It's Krampus, right?
Yeah.
I want to talk about real quick. One I never saw before called Christmas with the Cranks. Mm-hmm. Fucking horrible movie.
Yeah.
Yes.
Horrible.
I could have told you that. You wasted 2 hours of your life.
No.
If you're gonna go with a terrible Christmas movie like that, go with Deck the Halls.
Whoa. I forgot I saw that movie. That's right. But that movie I could get through, because the problem with Christmas with the Cranks is like I was mad. Just leave them alone. They don't want to celebrate Christmas. What the fuck?
Yeah.
So it's bullshit. So then I was like, when they were showing pictures of like the houses, but their houses were not decorated, I'm like, all right, I'm on your side now. They really should at least decorate, like try. So I'm like, all right, I'm going with this movie. And then the fucking daughter like, oh, I'm coming back. And then even though you're going on a vacation, like to the Cancun or whatever, I'm coming back. Now you gotta rush around and decorate. I'm like, fuck this movie. And I turned off right away. Where I decked the hall, I went through the whole thing. So I was like, of course, this had to suck because Tim Allen's in it. Of course.
Yeah.
Like, if he's starring, it's gonna be a terrible movie. So that's a PSA for you guys out there. I watched that Murray Christmas thing, the Bill Murray trying to do that, like, you know, mm-hmm. Frank Sinatra style, like, you know, singing Christmas songs, Christmas thing. Did you guys see that?
No.
On Netflix?
I watched most of it, and we had to go or do something else, so we had to turn it off, and I have yet to
decide. It basically peaks with the Chris Rock scene. Yeah. That's where it peaked, and then it just became that standard shit for me. So
yeah, it sort of fell flat.
But what I want to plug right now is we watched on Christmas Day that there's a show, a British show called Black Mirror, and they put the Christmas episode up from last year with John Hamm. It's a fucking phenomenal show.
Yeah,
I've seen
some of it. I've been wanting to watch the crit, but my girlfriend is not a fan.
The show, she didn't like any of them. They're different. Like that's like watching Twilight Zone, but British.
It's hard getting people to watch stuff that they're not. You know, like she watched some of one of them, and the stuff that she's heard about the show, she's just like, "There's no way I'm fucking watching that."
Oh man, that fucking the pig thing. That was a great jump off episode. Like, once that episode, remember that, Stu?
Which one?
When the prime minister had to fuck a pig to save girl.
That was gross.
And then the one with the, like, you can, like see, like your past through your eyes and you can rewind it. That was fucking a mind fuck right there. Which they incorporate in this Christmas episode. But I want to spoil the whole thing. Watch this episode. It's great. What else did I do? Oh, I want to talk about it last week, but we'll talk about it now. We saw Star Wars last week.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, you saw that too, Mark?
Yeah.
Star Wars.
All right. Well, we got some spoilers for you guys. If you don't want to hear it, here it goes.
Solo dies.
On a count of three, if you don't want to hear spoilers, get out of here. Three. All right. There's like fucking like spaceships flying and fucking like people lightsabering and shit like that. Words flying in space. I think the, also there's like
aliens
and stuff, and it takes robots place. Also. Yeah, it takes robots place in the past, like way in the past, mm-hmm, like in a galaxy that's nowhere near here. That's all I'm gonna say about that. If you that's haven't seen it, but then again, if you haven't seen this movie, you're a fucking asshole at this point.
It's really fucking good. I liked it a lot. Yeah. There was a kid, so I went to the.
When did you go? Like right away
Thursday.
Last Thursday or yeah. Oh, New Year's Eve or Christmas Eve? I mean,
no. Thursday, the day before that
midnight
it came
shit.
Out.
Yeah, wow.
No, not even midnight. Okay, 7 o'clock. Ooh. It was the first showing they had over here in Manville.
Right.
I got tickets, no problem, online. Like everyone was complaining about it, like saying like, oh, they're going to be sold out. You know, selling all the advance tickets. And it was like well after everyone already got their tickets. I went online, simple as pie, got a ticket. No big deal.
Yeah, I was surprised because the show we went to see, which was Saturday, that was like the front row was pretty empty, remember, Stu? But going back where we were, it was that's when
everyone,
it kind of filled up.
It was just a fight for seats.
Yeah,
that's all the pre-sales was about.
Yeah, well, there was a kid. So, like, I'm sitting in a seat, the previews start. There's a one seat in between me and, like, the next group of people. And this kid comes and is like, is anyone sitting here? Yeah. No, he sits down. Is like super jittery and like oh yes Star Wars it's gonna happen this is it
it's gonna happen I wouldn't use for this moment
Star Wars comes on the screen he's screaming he's out of his seat he's like the loudest kid in the theater the second the Millennium Falcon's on screen he's clapping and whooping and hollering Han Solo gets fucking stabbed
you're gonna spoil like that
kid,
damn
I already said it
you did okay I'm sorry.
Cries hysterically, sobbing, like no, and like I can hear him sniffling for the rest of the fucking movie. He's like 20 years old, and he's it was an embarrassing sight.
I apologize if you guys didn't know that out there, but I found out what was weird is that Monday when I was on the computer, once you type in Han Solo, it immediately drops down to that what you just said. It's like wow, you can't even avoid spoilers if you're trying to. So. I apologize if Mark didn't say, but like, yet again, like I said, if you haven't seen Star Wars by now, you're an asshole.
Yeah,
so it's your fault.
Man, get on the ball.
Any shows?
And I did you see that coming? Like when they first met on the bridge?
Yeah.
I kind of was like, okay, something's not gonna go right. Well, and even if you didn't know that, like once they kind of like bonded it for a second, and then he's like, let me hold your thing for you.
For
and
a second,
like, sure.
I really there was a going up, leading up to it. I thought one of them's gonna die. And I thought about if Han's going to kill his kid. I'm like, that's not going to happen. Plus, they're leading up for this guy to be, like, the main villain of the thing.
Yeah.
But it's going to take 3 movies to get there, you know?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
So they're not going to let this guy die. Like, we're too invested in his story.
I also found that, actually, like, what was interesting about, like, his, like, their like, with Han Solo dying is that I felt like Han Solo, like, Harrison Ford probably said, dude, I'm fucking 70 years old.
Oh, yeah.
I don't want to do these movies anymore. Just kill me off. But, like, fucking Carrie Fisher, like, will not turn down a check. So she's I'll be in 770 in those. I don't give a shit. And she definitely needs the money, so.
Yeah. I was surprised at how little, you know, Mark Hamill was in it. Like, he's only in it till at the very end, you know. And there's, like, one shot that was in the trailer where he's, like, grabbing R2-D2 all cloaked. And
okay.
There's a thing in the first trailer that they put out. I was just thinking about this morning. I woke up thinking about this for some reason.
But nerd!
I know. In the first trailer that they ever put out for it, there was you hear Luke talking, and he's like, the Force is strong in my family. Like, my father has it. My sister has it.
Yeah, that one. I got it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where the fuck
and then
was
he's
that?
Not in it.
That's not in the movie.
I like when they do that in trailers.
I mean, sometimes...
You saw the trailer for that...
They're building up for the next one.
You guys saw the trailer for that Zootopia movie, right?
What?
You saw the trailer for that Zootopia movie with the sloths?
Yes!
Like, if they put that in the movie, it's not going to be worth it. So I'm thinking they should just cut it out.
Dude, that's
honestly. It was funny as hell.
Best scene ever.
Yeah. Like, but when you get to that scene in the movie, aren't you going to be like, oh, I've seen this already, it's not funny?
So I'd still laugh at it. I've watched it again.
Okay. I mean, that's the first example I can think of, so I've been torn to see if they'll put it in or not.
It happens a lot with comedies these days, now that everything's a lot of improv, you know?
Yeah.
They'll do different takes, and then the trailer cutters will use someone.
That's the Judd Apatow treatment, you know?
Exactly. It's the Apatowing of America.
So before we get into a question I have to ask about, Stu, if I was too harsh on someone, I want to actually get Lil Jon's opinion of the movie. What'd you think, Lil Jon? Oh, shot, 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 yes, shot, shot, yes. same thing as always. Are you sure you want to go with those, you guys?
I'm gonna get water again. Why are all the green ones water?
No. I was just trying to psych you out. Alright, is it water or vodka? What we'll find out.
Oh, more vodka. I know.
Three vodka. For three? Yes! We gotta get a water one, dude. Did I put water in there? Besides one? Ugh. Alright, so we went with one of my friends from high school. He looks so sad, Mark. Mark's not much of a drinker, which
I'm not a fan of major ska.
Well, what about the drink though?
Oh man. I think they should distill it five times if this is four times.
Put more water in it right away. So we went with one of my friends in high school to see this movie. Mm-hmm. He brought a friend of his who's kind of a nice way to put it, a nerd.
So what, remember? Star Wars nerd?
A little bit, yes.
Sci-fi nerd.
Yes, all the way. So, and he, when you see him, you'll know it. So it's funny, did you see that when we were waiting for the movie? I haven't seen him in so long, like since high school. So I turned to him, I'm like, oh, how you doing? And I don't want to say his name in case he's listening. But he knows I'm talking about him if he does.
Did Jarrell go to the movies with another friend from high school with a nerdy friend?
It couldn't have been me. So I'm like, he must have asked the same question to him, too. So I'm like, what have you been up to since 1996? You know, and he's like, not much. Like 20 years? You haven't done anything? Like, I expected him to say,
he read every friggin' Star Wars book. That's what he did in that time span.
I expected him to say, after we hung out,
I studied Star Wars. Yeah.
I went, I saw you at my friend's birthday party. Then Star Wars came out, and I came here. Wow, you must be tired. So anyway, after that, we're at the movie, we're eating at Applebee's, and I was like, I'll just be nice to him. And I was like, so how'd you like the movie? He goes off on, how it's not like the books and stuff, and talking about the other universes and everything like that. But did you notice, too, that every time, when he went on and on with that, I'm like, okay, great. So then I was like, so anyway, whatever you want to order. I talk about something totally different. Mm-hmm. And he just bring it back up and pull it back. It's like you're trying to turn away from it, and he just pull you back and just bring it up out of nowhere. And what's funny is, I wanted to ask you if you think I was rude about this, but he made some joke. Do you remember, Stu? Joke. And then, joke? We were talking about, what do you expect him to, go to this, planet and people there? And then my wife, Miss Zest, did a casual laugh at it, to be polite. And I was like, nobody got your joke. Was that rude? Because it kind of shut you. That shit down. Yeah. Because I don't want to keep that awkwardness going because she's laughing and it's like, yeah.
You can't not be yourself. Don't hold back.
Yeah. I had enough at that point. At that point, it was like every time I try to talk about something different, you bring it back to Star Wars, Star Trek, and how this person didn't do that, and how, who's the director of this one?
J.J. Abrams.
Yeah, J.J. Abrams talking. I really tried to go with it, but it was just too geeky for me.
Knew names I'd never heard of.
So your guy in the theater, Mark, that was...
I've never heard of.
The guy in the theater that was screaming could not handle this guy. If you played Star Trooper with him, you fucking lose in a second.
Yeah.
He was that nerdy. And he hasn't done anything in 20 years.
I'm glad that those kind of people still exist.
Yeah, it keeps the franchise going. That's what makes George Lucas happy, you know?
Well, not George Lucas, Disney now.
Yeah, he saw him on a red carpet, just mad as hell at the premiere of this movie, just frowning.
Yeah, because they already got their billion back. They give him a billion, wasn't it $1 billion?
So why would you be mad if you're getting money anyway?
Billion for it, and Disney makes it back? Oh, it was? All right.
He's just
bitter. Disney made their money back with one movie.
He's heard all this talk about the prequels, and he's just mad because this guy took his franchise and made everyone excited about it again. That's why he's frowning on the red carpet, you know. But it's
I don't even know why they even had him. He should have been hiding. Mm-hmm. He should have been I'm done with that.
Yeah, exactly.
What did you say? He needs to come out with Willow too.
Yeah, just work on that shit.
Work on Willow too. Damn it,
Willow too, or a fucking Howard the Duck too. Just something.
Howard the Duck too.
It's like he hasn't had an original thought since the '80s. Honestly,
too. That's up my alley.
Yeah. I love Willow. It's a good movie. Just do that. If you want, if you can't think of anything original, stop with the Star Wars shit. Go with that.
Get Val Kilmer a fucking sword again. Come on.
Yeah,
he's got a couple billion to make a good movie now.
He already worked with the Warwick Davis and as an Ewok anyway. I'm sure he's available. He'll jump at that. It's not like they're making Leprechaun movies anymore.
Well, did you know that he started the company that he started that was like computer graphics company that he couldn't bring it off the ground. He didn't have the money for it, so he sold it to fucking Steve Jobs, and it became fucking Pixar.
Wow. Food for thought, you guys.
Yeah.
Beer for thought, or whatever you guys are drinking out there.
So act on that million-dollar idea you've got out there, you know?
Yeah.
Anyone can make some
anyone. Money. Anyone. The thing I don't get about George Lucas, and we'll move on to our album review right now, is that, like, why, like, if I did something that was great and someone took it from me and made more out of it and I'm the laughing stock, I'm still making mad money off it. Would I be mad about it? Or would I just smile all the way to the bank?
I mean, I would smile all the way.
Exactly. Like, yeah, I would, like, you're right. I don't have an original thought in my body. I was milking this franchise because it was what made me the most money. You would do the same thing. And then the person giving me the shit, like, yeah, you're right. And the same thing. The Disney came to me with, like, a truckload of money and gave it to me and said, the only thing I have a problem about was every time in the writing room, I have an idea and they point to a picture of Jar Jar Binks and say, no, remember you did this? You just sit here. Don't even talk. That bothers me a bit. But I look at my bank account, I get over it. So same thing with him. I would do the same thing. But don't you even fucking think about taking this website from me. Both of you.
Before you go to album reviews, going on any shows? Shows? Anybody?
I am, actually. We're working on getting some interviews with Lamb of God, Anthrax, and Catch 22. Okay. That's in January. You went to see Pie Tasters last week, right?
No. I actually, we decided not to go to the city, and we decided to go to Roxy and Duke's, and we saw, which was a, we ended up seeing an awesome band anyway, which was Gas House Gorillaz.
Oh, yeah. Okay. My friend works sound over there, and he says that they're awesome.
Yeah, Gas House Gorillaz was really good. They're
should we try to interview them? They're that good?
Yeah, but I think they're only here.
See that name all the time
for the holidays.
They play Roxy and Duke's. Like, yeah. They're, when they circle around, they always play Roxy and Duke's.
Yeah, okay. But I believe they're not from around here.
Yeah,
so.
No. They're one of those bands that tours around
rockabilly
all the time, and they just sort of go. They do the same like
good rockabilly though,
because there's enough rockabilly band. Like,
they played some. They covered a Ramones song.
That's
pretty
much
like
the bar
too.
To see it. Yeah.
So it was like, you know, it's like a punk edge rockabilly.
All right, we'll get to interviewing them. You guys want to do some album reviews now?
Yeah.
Since we're a half hour into the opening of the show.
Oh, and Bouncing Souls tickets were going for $92, so I didn't go to that.
Good thing we're good friends with them.
Oh,
I think
we're
so close with them getting interviews like
that. We're so close.
Yeah. They hit me up all the time, everybody out there, and say, we got more music on our record label. You should come check it out. But then I wish the emails were more addressed to me, though. All right. Let's see. Here we go. We're cutting low on the beverages, so we'll sell a little John right now, because I'm kind of feeling it now anyway. All right.
Let me get a little more Nog then.
All right. Pour yourself some Nog. Pour me some Nog too. And then we'll cut right into the Kid Cudi's review. Don't go too much because I want some too. And I'm out of beer. So I got to hope I get more shots out of this thing. Okay. He wants more.
No, I'm saying.
He likes it, Mikey.
I'm
he likes it.
To you.
Oh, okay.
Giving you.
Oh, you don't want it?
No.
You don't like it?
Oh. I
drink. We'll split it.
I haven't had eggnog up to a point at this point because of my own.
You don't like eggs and nog?
It's
liquid egg. My eggs are supposed to be solid.
I never had it. It looks gross, but I had it when I was like in high school, like just plain eggnog. Mm-hmm. And since the Dropkick Murphys has that song, which is one of your favorite bands.
Oh, yeah.
The season's upon us. It's that time of year. Brandy and eggnog, there's plenty of cheer. I'm like, I should do that. And it's working. It's pretty good.
Then they had that song about crack cocaine, so you tried that too.
Jockey Murphy's had a crack cocaine song?
I'm just saying, you'll do anything.
I'll do anything a band tells me to. All right, so I couldn't listen to any more Nirvana, you know, because I'd be dead by now. All right, so Kid Cudi, you guys, is an alternative rapper from Cleveland. And he released his debut album, Man on the Moon, End of Days, in 2009. And this album is like a moody psychedelic album, preceded produces a unique sound that differs from the current hip-hop sound at that time.
I thought it was supposed to be punk rock.
Damn, I'm talking about their old album. Oh. His old album, sorry. So that album spawned the mellow hits Day and Night, as well as the pothead anthem Pursuit of Happiness, which appears in Mark's favorite film, Project X. You like the ironic statements I make about you, yeah. We'll talk about how much he hates that movie later. But so this, his first album is chock full of stoner joints. Pun. Though Cuddy's second album was a tad under par, Man on the Moon 2, : The Legend of Mr. Rager, it still continued the neo-psychedelic sound. But then by his third album, Indica Kid, I began to notice a decline in the quality of his music. The amount of throwaway tracks started to equal the number of good ones. But I haven't heard his, got a chance to hear his fourth album, Satellite Flight, The Journey to Mother Moon. Mostly because it was released with no promotion, really. Nor have I heard the rock style project of the Wizard thing he did. But I bet you, Mark, you have heard those albums. What would you say about those two?
Well, I never heard the
Satellite Flight.
Satellite.
Okay. Yeah. So you've heard Wizard.
I heard Wizard. It was pretty good. It had like some good stuff to it.
What kind of music is it though? Is it?
It's more
it's
like
a side project, right?
It's kinda, yeah, it's rock. Like, well, it's not rock. Rock. It's like a hip hop guy made with a producer that thinks he knows what rock music is. It's like guitars over hip hop beats and sort of slower. It's like a Kid Cudi album with guitars.
Okay. So with this album, when I learned about his fifth album, I was ecstatic to hear that Mr. Rager had a new album out, and I was eager to hear what he had in store for me. But a warning to you guys out there listening, this is not a rap album. And Kid Cudi stressed this on his Twitter by saying it's an experimental punk rock grunge album inspired by the 90s indie music scene.
Yeah, I didn't.
Now
I sensed like a little teeny bit of punk in it, but
right,
not much.
So in light of our recent Coldplay review, I like to go first with my review because just in case you guys disagree with me, I have no way to back out of it and be like, oh, I wasn't going to say that and change my mind, which I almost did with the last one. No, I wouldn't have done that. I'm just
groupthink.
I don't care.
Groupthink.
So I'm actually nervous to say what I think because this is a 26-track album consisting of two discs, 18 songs on disc one,
and a whole bunch of
eight
shit
demos
on disc two.
Outtakes.
Just keep my mouth shut.
Yeah. And which adds up to 90 minutes of music. So after two listens, I can honestly and safely say this album is a magnificent piece of shit. This record is just as much of a corporate complete mess as the Miley Cyrus Dead Presidents Dead Pets album that we listened to in September. I'm not going to waste my time and breath talking about each song, really. Instead, here is like the summary of the different layers of shit on this album. So you got songs with extremely repetitive riffs or beats that go absolutely nowhere in tracks like Edge of the Earth, which features muffled, distorted, lazy vocals on the guitars. Or you got the song, which is called Confused, which has like the generic Kurt Cobain-esque like guitar loop.
That song was actually all right. I thought that one was all right.
But
I think that was the only song I actually
liked. Though. And it's like, was this going anywhere? And it's like, nope. That's all it's going. It's just going to do this over and over and over.
So that's how I felt with a lot of it. You know, it's like my whole thing through the whole CD was just like, God, I would hate to be the guitar player in this. And then I found out that he played all the fucking instruments. So like he just did it himself, and it's like no quantization, no like computerized syncing it up. It's like this is just if you have shitty rhythm, that's why we're suffering. Like now, like I don't know. Like plus Kid Cudi's never had like the most melodic voice. So like there's times where he tries and it just kind of I think it fails.
Right, and then there are also songs on here that start off potentially good, but get old really fast. Like Man in the Night and Wedding Tux are prime examples, while the track Angered Kid has a formula of crunchy analog guitars, random yelling, and made-up lyrics that then repeat. over and over again.
Good thing they're not digital guitars.
Then there are the abysmal and disgraceful tracks that are bad from the start, which you'll find in the songs The Nothing, which is more muffled vocals, pseudo lyrics about an acid trip, I suppose, and the song Judgmental Cunt, which I guess is what I'm being kind of like right now. And speaking of judgmental or judging, they fucking get Mike Judge to come in on different songs.
Oh, I know.
And have Beavis and Butthead comment on each track, like, ah, that was cool. That was cool. This, and then Butthead be like, oh, this is like the greatest thing ever. You should try some acid.
No, like, it was mushrooms.
We should try some mushrooms.
He gave that's not meant so well. Butthead gave Beavis mushrooms.
How the fuck did he kind of get these two to sell out to this shit? Really makes me question, how big was that fucking check? Like, I mean, I know they haven't been working since 1995 or something like 97, but really, you do not need to sell out to this. Like, I'm a big fan of Beavis, but I love that show, but that just was a dagger in my fucking heart. Anyone got to, like, you guys used to watch that show, I mean.
Yeah, especially because the album's terrible.
And the fact that they put them on there over and over and over, it's such a joke that it was just dead right away.
Yeah.
If it was supposed to be a joke, I don't know what the point was. It's supposed to be experimental, giving Beavis Butthead on the song. But, man, that's like, that just really fucking hurts.
The whole thing, to me, like, when I was listening to it, I'm like, this sounds like the shitty demo that, like, you know, whoever, like, the guitar player in the band would, like, give to the band to be like, this is what it should be like, and then the band like makes it better and like puts it together right, and the producer comes in and like makes it sound good, and this is like step one of like a songwriting process that should have kept going from where he finished
and
it.
Keep in mind, this has been an artist that's been around since like mid 2000. I guess that'd be in the future.
But he's always taken risks and been experimental with shit. So, like, I can't totally fault the album because I'm like, at least he's trying to do something different, even if it's garbage. But, like, don't put that out. You know? Like,
well, speaking of demos, you said before, like, what do you want to say, Stu, about the demo, the second disc? Let's get into that real quick.
Yeah, it was shitty fucking recordings.
Right.
It sounded like it sounded like they had one mic in the middle of the room and were playing. But now that you said that he played all the instruments, that's even worse. So now it's him plugging in his phone and recording each track individually with a microphone in the open air and then mixing it. It just sounded like total shit.
Yeah. I don't know. Just to me, it sounded like he wants to be fucking Kurt Cobain so bad. That, you know how, like, Kurt Cobain's album came out in November with
demos. You're
right,
it needed a producer. I mean, yeah, there was no producer helping him.
It's like, he's like, oh, well, Kurt Cobain's music.
I think he did everything.
He's like, well, Kurt Cobain put out an album of demos, and everyone jumps on that. I'm just as much of a genius as he is. Let me put out my fucking demos, and everyone will jump on that. People are like, oh, shit, Kid Cudi just farted on the mic. It's fucking, let's record it. The man's a fucking genius. Fuck that guy, man. It's bullshit. Now, for the good news, out of all 26 tracks, there are 6 pretty decent songs to me. Stu mentioned a song
in the first CD.
Yeah. First. All right. You're right. That's 18. But it gives more credit then. I don't want to do that. You still put 26 songs on this bullshit. And you had 6 good songs on here, which in my opinion are 6 good songs. You said the Confused song. I don't really like that song. But the song Fade to Red is an example of the punk rock you were talking about. It was like a punk rock grunge song that I was hoping the whole album would be like. Like, do you remember that, like, a time mark that you actually enjoyed the record?
There was a couple things on it where I was like, well, all right, this is at least a decent rhythm. Mm-hmm. You know, like, some parts show that he's been a musician in the past.
Yeah.
But there was definitely a couple songs where I thought it was listenable for a period of time, and then like most of the time it just kept going to the point where I was like, well, that just made it all irrelevant.
All right, so did you actually like that song, some song to mention, but did you find a song you can get all the way through and you were content with a song?
No,
okay,
not really.
All right, I'm afraid on our final verdicts then, but I found there were 2 songs that like had an acoustic, like a guitar tune that I liked. But they suffer from his horrible lyrics when he's just like, why, meow, meow, meow. That's great. It's like, the fuck are you talking about, dude? Just Be serious, man. I also love the title track and the closing song on the first disc, Embers, was cool with this like slow guitar strumming. So I don't want to like to me. I was so excited for this album that when I heard he was putting out a new record, an experimental album, I left a space in my top 10 for him. I was ready to put him in there. I was like, all right, this is going to be great. And I was expecting to be surprised, but obviously since I didn't like the last time I heard Indica, I'm not surprised I didn't like this one. And that, but I would call this bullshit, but I think it's like actually insulting to bullshit. Because bullshit actually is what it is. This is the work of like a Picasso or someone like that. Like just throwing shit on a canvas and saying this is art.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think he went for the look I'm on drugs and out of control thing a little too much.
Yeah, this it's actually...
It's like the lyrics didn't make sense.
I blame his drug dealer. Shit
that did not make sense.
His drug dealer is at fault for this album. It is his fault that he's getting this guy so fucked up on this shit and he's putting out this bullshit. But in the bullshit that he puts in...
Or he's lying about it, and he really needs to take those drugs to make a good album.
Nah, you can tell this guy is on some. If you would stop recording and say, yeah, that was great, I'm going to put this out. Like, you got to, like, wake up the next day, let their drugs, like, sober, like, get out of your system, then let's do it again, and then you can like, send it to the record company. Like, this is, like... I'm just baffled. Maybe, this is horrible.
He had a contract and he just had to put out something.
Yeah. I don't know.
Well, supposedly he's supposed to be putting out Man on the Moon 3.
I'm scared now.
It was supposed to be his next album. Then he was like, I got so much shit I'm working on. Like, supposedly he just records tons of stuff all the time.
Yeah, he's a Tupac of our generation, but like... he sucks nowadays.
Well, yeah, so.
My final verdict is this. Like I said, this, like, you got the shit. You did through that shit for, like, some small pieces of medium-rare steak that are worth eating. So with the fact that...
Now it's shit next to them.
I know, it's covered. You gotta wash it off, though.
Yeah.
But, and I don't know if you want to still digest it. You guys out there listening, you can decide that for yourself.
Is it already cooked steak?
Yeah, it's medium-rare. I'm not saying it's... Obviously, it's the best kind... Well, no, I'll say it's worse than medium-rare.
Is it on cow shit? Or is it human shit? Oh, bullshit. Oh.
Bullshit is actually in the
cow
grass.
Cow shit washes shit. Off easier than yeah. human shit I've found.
Bullshit. you washed it off normally? All right, you've usually eaten steak with like shit all over it? You were that hungry? That's what I'm saying.
I won't touch it if there was human shit on it. But cow shit, you know, it's like straw and like duty particles.
You got the analogy, basically, right?
I get it.
If it's only 6 moments of goodness in this bullshit, is it worth the time? You figure it out there, you
Give
guys.
Give me that meat and that shit.
And what really kills me is they fucking put Beavis and Butthead on there. The greatest duo of the 90s. And made them sell out to this.
We heard.
Oh, my God. I don't know what to give this. I'm actually torn because I like some moments. But...
I think you know what to do.
I don't know. I'm going to have to just... It's barely something you can skip. It's barely skippable. You should be angry this exists in the realm of
no,
fuck this album.
I disagree.
But it's barely skippable. That's my rating.
I disagree. It was interesting listening to.
I'm about to kill you, man. If you give it any higher than Skip It...
I'm not giving it any higher than a skip it.
Go outside right now and walk about.
I'm giving it a high skip it.
High skip it. Okay. Like, up in the air, like you're like at least 6 feet in the air while you're skipping along. Skipping it like that?
Yeah.
All right. Mark, don't let me down.
Well.
I loved it.
I got to go with my initial response to it, which I was in the car listening to it, and I was like, Bree, we got to listen to these records. Like, we got to listen to them. I know that sucks. But we'll save the one for last that I think you'll like, which is Cage the Elephant. But like we're driving around all day, gotta put this in. And I had to go back to it because I fucking ejected it and threw it out the window and said, fuck this.
You had to turn around and drive back and pick it up off the street?
I listened to it on the computer after that.
Okay.
But yeah, no, I say fuck this. Because wow. That's how strongly I felt the first time I listened to it.
Yes. I'm going to give you a double fart sound on that, because thank you. You fucked everything up, Kid Cudi. But suppose you actually want to go through a torture or nightmare like the three of us did. Let us know when you hear this album in the comment section, or you can send us an email. Tell us what you think of this record. Did you like it? Are you fucking crazy? Did you hate it? Are you a normal person like the rest of society? We're eager to hear what you think. I actually forgot to tell a joke. I want to do jokes every time we do like shows. Like, yeah. You guys loved my last joke, right?
What, like with a pre-planned out joke?
Yeah.
Like a line and punchline?
I think we should do jokes every show.
I think if they fit the music.
No, not before we do this. The thing. Just do jokes every time.
No.
What's your joke?
All right. See, he wants to hear it. What do you call a pig with three eyes?
What?
A pig.
That's why you don't. Is that from your daughter?
I'm on my pocket. You know you liked it. All right, more shots. Maybe you'll find it funnier with more drinks.
Oh, water.
Oh, God.
Water. I guess Mark did not get water. You are 3 for 3, man. You like this game so far? Is it fun?
I don't like my palate being tricked like that. I like to mentally prepare for vodka or water.
Yeah.
Because even the water tastes gross, because I'm preparing for vodka and it's water, and I'm like, yeah.
I don't agree with you at all. I think the water is very satisfying. Water is great,
I wouldn't
man.
Know.
Yeah. You are drinking water right now, you cheater. Yeah.
That's what I am expecting it though.
Okay.
In this solo cup.
Who knows? Next one, Chris Brown album Royalty. Chris Brown, in case you didn't know, you're living under a rock as an R&B singer and occasional actor. And since 2005, he's released 6 albums and a collaboration album with Kyga called Fan of a Fan earlier this year. These albums have produced several hits like Run It, Deuces, Hell Yeah, 3 times. I don't know why I said hell, but just call it Yeah 3 times, and Loyal. He's also worked with Busta Rhymes, Rick Ross, T-Pain, Lil Wayne, Usher, and Nicki Minaj. And this album, Royalty, is named after his newborn daughter, so I assumed it was going to be full of sentimental songs about family, love, and not a lot of profanity and sexual promiscuous tracks. Right off the gate.
Definitely he doesn't want to fuck anybody to sleep.
That was the first song off the gate. First track, Fuck You Back to Sleep, proves that theory was completely wrong. Although this throwback slow jam does have a nice beat, I did enjoy. So did you like the Fuck You Back to Sleep song?
It made me laugh. But I can't take it seriously. Yeah. And then, like, okay, I was like, okay, maybe he'll make me laugh the whole time. But no, the other songs, I was like, all right, cool beat. And then he just starts talking, and I hate it.
Yeah, like, I know what you're saying. Like the song.
I don't like R&B that much, so.
I can see where you're going with that.
You'd be twisting my arm.
Fine by Me is a dance track in the same vein as The Weeknd song Can't Feel My Face. That's not a bad thing, I'm saying. It's a very catchy, upbeat tune. Sure to get people on the dance floor. So if he wants to copy what The Weeknd's doing or whoever did what first, I have no problem with that. Next song, Wrist, sounds like a Future song, a Future rapper, and that is a bad thing. Not just because I hate trap music, but because for a trap song is extremely bland and generic, which is saying a lot. After the throwaway R&B track Liquor, where he repeats over and over, all I want to do is drink and fuck. Things get back on track with the song Zero. This is one of those disco funk tunes about Chris giving zero fucks about a girl. It's a good but reminiscent of The Weeknd yet again.
Yeah, I thought that song was not terrible.
Mm. Like, you didn't expect...
It was nice compared to what came before it.
Well, with the song before that, you didn't like...
No, 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 I just like...
Liquor? You didn't like Liquor?
Like, I'll say this.
I thought it was going to be about Liquor.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's why I was excited, and I was like, oh, man, it's about some girl.
The first song, Fuck You Back to Sleep.
Yeah, go ahead.
I, it, that, like, the the dagger in my heart and like the distaste that I had for this album at that point like extended until that song, and I was like, all right, this is not bad.
Okay, so the album for R&B haters starts off as you want to slit your wrists and jump off a building at the same time. Mm-hmm. But eventually, when he says he goes give zero fucks about a girl or girls that he's fucking, all in the vein of his lovely new daughter, is when it gets great. But then in
nope, horrible.
I'm a big fan of late 80s and 90s new jack swing music, as well as like the West Coast G-Funk sound. So I must admit, the song Picture Me Rolling is right up my fucking alley with the Dr. Dre synth keys and like the heavy bass lines. But then the album falls into a slump during the middle. More jump on the bandwagon trap songs like Who's Gonna and a song about fucking he sings, like the song A Little Bit, which I was like, I guarantee you this fucking song is about, I want to put my dick in just a little bit. I would not be surprised if that's what it's about.
Yeah.
And sure enough, that's exactly what the song's about. It's like, you're getting fucking predictable now with your music.
He wants to ring the doorbell. Yeah. Ding dong, can I get in? Yeah. Can I come in? Ding dong, ding dong.
Like, I think you guys were more interested. Did you find, like, your peak, your interest after Zero, like, went back down again?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, like, well, overall, I thought he was garbage.
Okay. So, what about you, Stu? What did you think after the Little Bit song? Or before that happened? Were you just like, fuck this album?
No, I would hear the beat. I'd be like, oh, and then he'd open his mouth.
Yeah, like, musically, I didn't mind the album. Like, it was definitely more enjoyable than I don't, some other stuff.
I don't know. It's like guy singing. I mean, maybe if I was a female, maybe I'd like it.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where I'm like, it's not made for me. You know, it's like,
he's trying to be, like, romantic. I don't know. I couldn't eat. Can you imagine having sex to that? Would you have sex to that?
Yes, I did. Tell your mom thanks. Well, what I did was, I was like, when I listened to it, it's kind of like, I'm kind of like, I don't really hate it, but it's just like, I find with his lyrics, like, when we reviewed Jamie Foxx, it's just, R&B to me has turned a corner where it's just like, let me be as vulgar as possible.
Yeah.
But have the sweet music in the background, and people will ignore it. But I can't like just be grinding on a girl and listening to, like, someone say, like, you know, I don't give zero fucks about you. Let me put it in just a tip. I just start cracking up and my boner goes away. Did you guys listen to the whole album or just the deluxe
version? The whole album,
the deluxe version.
With the boner intact. I don't think I listened to the deluxe track.
Okay, so you guys went all the way to track 13 then, which is called No Filter. When he brings, like, the dance funk back, so, that, like, you guys listening out there, like, eventually there's no dance music, then it gets back up to, the dance stuff, which is what I like. Like, so, that slow R&B shit is not working for me if he wants to be vulgar, but when he wants to pull the dance shit, I'm like, all right, this is cool. So, but unfortunately, this one, the song No Filters, is too repetitive lyrically and musically to the point my mind started to wander halfway through. So anyway, the deluxe track has 4 additional songs, which features bouncy songs like Day One, a slow jam ballad, Blow It in the Wind, a song You Did It featuring the guy who helped make trap music the biggest trend of 2015, Future. I always say musicians should wait at least 2 years before releasing albums. That way they can have more time to be creative. Because Chris Brown's last album, X, came out last year, and the fact that the album he did with Tiger came out last March, this album really was rushed and uninspired. It's pretty much 14 songs with 4 added B-sides that weren't good enough to be on an official release. Plus, why name the album after your kid, but mostly sing about trying to fuck bitches? I'm sure royalty will grow up, hear this album, and be like, wow, daddy, you sure were pretty horny back in the day. She will be so proud. Perhaps having some more mainstream rappers on this would have helped more for me. So, but what do you guys want to give your final verdicts? That was my problem, mostly. Mark, you first.
There was a song with Nas on this one, though, right?
Yeah.
I like that. I like Nas. He should.
Anytime he shows up, you're happy.
I think I might have skipped the Nas track.
I feel like Nas should show up on other people's albums, and then it should just become a Nas record.
Yeah. But out of the 13 songs...
Yeah, I'd say I liked about 2.5 or 3.
Uh-huh.
And, if I'm going to rate it, I would say skip it.
Oh, well, you weren't that mad. Cool.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, I like the, like, disco-ishness songs, and I liked some of the music and the beats I thought were decent, and, like, some of the songs were good up until he ruined them. Like, oh, this is all right, and then it's like, and I'm going to fuck you in your ass, girl, and it's like, all right, man, come on, just be a little more discreet.
Yeah.
I don't need to hear about it.
What about you, Stu? What do you think?
If it was full-blown comedy, like if it was trying Lonely to be Island, like R&B it was, album. If it was trying to be comedy, like way over the top, like baby, I'm gonna baby, I'm gonna fuck you in half, split you in half. Yeah, that would be better.
Yeah,
but yeah, no, I can't take it seriously, and it's R&B rapping bullshit. So I give it a total fuck this.
All right, you're that. The thing about Stu is, you guys know out there, he hates R&B music. Yet to do a phenomenal record, which I'll be shocked if the Weeknd's album makes his list. But I agree with you, Mark. This is something you can skip. But if you guys want to let us know what you think, let us know in the comments or send us an email. What you think of the new Chris Brown album? Did you love it? Did you hate it? We don't know what you think. And we're almost done with these waters or vodka, right, Lil Jon? Oh, I'm gonna pick the pink one.
Everybody! I can see Lacey.
Can't smell it.
No, I didn't smell it. I saw Lacey.
You said lacing? What does that
mean? Yeah, lacing. It sticks to the glass different, because it's got different surface tension than water.
All right. Is that some of the bar science you learned on Bar Rescue?
Bar Rescue. You're lacing in these goddamn tanks!
Fucking vodka
sting. What'd you get?
Stings.
I got water on that one.
Fuck you.
There's only a few left, so I will kill one because we might just do one more. Shit. What should I pick? You guys pick for me. I'm going to do another one because that was just water.
Spin it like a fucking gun.
Is there even anything in this one?
There's nothing in it. It's empty.
Oh, it's empty? Okay, I'm sorry. In that case, let me have it. Then I'll just put fucking in it. That way it's fair, you know? I must have...
You actually wanted a shot of vodka and you got water?
Because I had two waters in a row.
Well, you're a cheater. So we learned that Jarrell can cheat at this game. So Mark, if you want water, feel free to pour a shot glass of water or vodka.
Yeah, I cheated and put vodka in my drink. I'm such an asshole.
That's what you wanted.
No, because I missed a drink. That's why I'm saying sorry.
Yeah.
I apologize because they're so clear. I thought I put something in there. All right. Our final review is Caged Elephant, Tell Me I'm Pretty. So I think a lot of people might not know who they are because I was talking to this guy at work. Like, we're reviewing Caged Elephant. He's like, who's that? But he's like indie underground dude. So, but in case you're too popular or famous to know them, too mainstream to know them, Caged Elephant is an indie rock band from Kentucky who formed in 2006. After the debut self-titled album, the follow-up Thank You, Happy Birthday, which was released in 2011, and that one features a heavy influence sound reminiscent of the Pixies, both vocally and musically. By their third album, Melophobia, the band attempted to create their own musical identity by becoming more psychedelic and garage rock-oriented. To me, they sounded a lot more like the White Stripes on that album with the distorted guitars and then like the fact that Matthew Schultz has like the Jack White like vocals. With this latest album, which is their fourth album, after the first few listens, I liked like the lo-fi garage rock sound on Mess Around, and I liked the mellow blues rock tune on the song Too Late to Say Goodbye. But after hearing those two songs, I started to notice they had like quite a sound like the Black Keys. Then I come to find out that Dan Auerbach from the Black Keys produced this record. Perhaps he's a little too influential on this one, but by that point I was only halfway through, so I don't want to judge too soon. Did you guys know he produced this album? And
I knew before.
You knew before then? I immediately thought of that band when I heard like the first three songs.
I don't know who
songs.
The Black Keys are.
Sorry. Okay, he apologized. It's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I heard that he had produced it before I listened to it. And so I went in kind of prejudiced and didn't like it too much the first time. I like a couple songs I liked. And then I like kept thinking about it. And then also, this was supposed to be for last week. We were supposed to review it.
Right.
So I started giving it more of a shot.
Okay.
And I'll say, like, I fucking really like this album. It's turned me, like, completely 180 from when I started. And I thought, like, I think it's, like, really fucking good. Like, there's some songs, like, even, because the thing I didn't like about it at first is that it's really, it's a slower pace for them from the past. Like, the thing I really liked about their second album is that they're, have this energy, this freneticism to them, I guess.
Like the Pixies.
But, kind of like the Pixies, yeah. So the second album I like a lot. Then the last one I didn't grab me as much, although I like a couple of the songs on it. But this one, having listened to it a bunch, I really like a lot of it. And even like the slowest song on the album is probably my favorite. Like I think it's like the best song on there.
Okay, so like you went into this at first wanting to sound like what like the Pixies.
Yeah.
But now you're accepting the fact that they're branching out, which they did on the last album. But
yeah.
To me,
it makes me want to go back and listen to the last one because I never really gave it that big of a shot, except for a couple songs.
All right. So for me, honestly, like I don't want to judge them right away, but I think the song that me and Mark will agree on that we love is the song "Trouble," which is a like both sweet sounding and unique with this like relaxed guitar strumming and like the background chimes. It's kind of got like the atmospheric like space rock sound of like bands from the mid '90s. I don't want to just go with Space Hog. But that's the only band I could think of that did that kind of stuff because that's what the name of the band is. So from this point, we are treated to a slow acoustic rock number, which is called How Are You True? And an upbeat ragtime tune called That's Right, which has like the New Orleans like feel to it. And then Punching Bag, which sounds like a Black Keys song, which is my biggest gripe about this album.
Yeah.
I didn't like that song. And then the final song, which is the Portuguese Knife Fight. Which is, like, again, Black Keys-ish.
I like...
I thought it was cool.
My biggest gripe with the album is I feel like the track listing is wrong.
What do you mean?
That Portuguese... It ends so not... It doesn't feel like the end of an album. Like, it doesn't have the same punch that, like, it should, I think, to really end a record. I felt like it should have been in the middle, and there should have been... I mean, I don't have my own fantasy track listing for this album, but just, like, listening to it, I never realized that it's the end... Until that's all of a sudden it ends and the new first song kicks in again.
So still being that you didn't like you never heard of the Black Keys, this will be
I have no points of reference to any bands that are like this.
Your review would be fair then. What do you think as a new listener?
I thought it was very bland. Sorry.
Okay.
I was just bored.
It was only 10 tracks, by the way, and you were bored in the 38 minutes, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, which I totally understand.
But then again, I was listening to it on...
Acid.
Pressured... No. I was listening under a pressured circumstance I had to listen to it before you got to my house to pick me up.
Jesus, man. You only gave me 2 weeks to do it, but go ahead. What did your final rating? I don't have it on here. Really?
Right. Sorry, I hate being so negative. I just didn't like anything this week.
All right. I can see that. Well, this is a short album, like I told. Like I said, it's only a little over a half hour, 10 tracks. So really, it's really easy to blast through this one really quickly. But now they sound like a little bit of the White Stripes and the Black Keys with like had a baby while listening to like 70s guitar rock in the background. So maybe the fifth album will be more original to me. But they did have some good tunes, though, like I said. So I'm going to say this album you can download. Mark, what do you think? Final verdict.
Well, for me, I would say buy it.
So I think what Mark is saying, as I push the button here, you have to listen to the album 17 times and then you'll realize.
I mean, the thing is, if you like... Yeah, I mean, but you got to be a fan of this kind of music. You know, like, it's not going to convert someone who, you know, listens to rap. You know, like, I can understand it's boring. It's like my biggest complaint is that it overall it's a little slow for my tastes. I like them as a band. I like them when they're more energetic.
Yeah.
But like I said, I thought the best written song was that song How Are You True.
Oh, you did like that song. Okay.
I thought that song is like, it sounds like a Beatles, Bowie-esque like thing. Like, it fucking blew me away that they...
Yeah.
Like, I felt like knowing them as a band in the past, like, I've been a fan of theirs for a few years now.
Yeah.
And I felt like they really outdid themselves. As songwriters, not just as, like, alternative band members. You know, like, I don't know.
Yeah. I like Trouble in the last two songs the best, but... For me, it's just, I like what Mark's saying, you have to be a fan, basically, of the two bands we mentioned you're kind of biting off of. If you don't like that sound that's been dominating, like, the alternative airways for the past few years, then this isn't for you. But if you like Black Keys, you'll like this. If you like the White Stripes back in the day, you'll like this. If you like 70s rock music, you'll like this. They do all that stuff. But if you want to hear something completely new and original and different, this is not, stay away from this album. But if you heard an album,
I liked Kid Cudi better.
That's something. That's saying something. No, you didn't.
I liked Kid Cudi better.
Did he?
That pisses me off.
He got the same ratings, though. No, you didn't. Oh, you're saying...
There, dug it in.
If you had a
Kid
choice...
Kid Cudi better.
Yeah. Well, if you guys heard the album...
True. There was no Beavis
and Butthead
on KGL. Yeah.
That's what he ate it most. Where's Dari on this shit? But let us know what you think of the new Cage the Elephant album in the comments or concerns.
There's that Cage the Elephant song where they're like, la, 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 la.
This is my stuff. Yeah, let us know in the comments or send us an email. We'd love to know what you think about this record. So we are making great time, and we're about to get into the our top 10 lists of the year. But real quick, I want to just mention my best and worst of 2015. Because we're coming to the end of the year. Everything I liked and hated about the year. If you guys want to sit around and talk about it a little bit.
Rest in peace, the lion.
Yeah,
peace
we...
The lion.
I forgot about the lion, man.
Oh, you saw that on there?
People forget about all this shit. Like, yeah. Yes. There's so many outrages that happen and then people forget about the next week because there's something else that's stupid that pops up.
Yeah. All right, real quick, let's finish these drinks off. I'm going with the green.
Everybody!
Wait.
Everybody!
Does alcohol have like a weight to it? Because this feels light.
That's water.
It feels light.
You got like, water.
I got fucking vodka.
How do you know?
You could
just
look at it.
Because it's my fucking luck.
Let's look at your faces.
Oh.
Yes.
Vodka.
Like, it felt like the way you feel it in your hand, that's why I realized it as we finish these, how you can tell. So, all in all, I think it was a fun game. Vodka roulette. Play it at home, everybody. Basically, what you do, you put a bunch of shot glasses, some vodka, some water. You pick out what you want.
Can I suggest?
Random drink. Okay.
Do like apple pie roulette next time.
Like an actual apple pie.
No, like that fucking McGillicuddy's.
Okay. Whatever. I was going to say, can we actually play with guns next time? Can we play real roulette like men? All right. So real quick, my favorite moments of 2015, beside the birth of my son, is Straight Outta Compton was a great movie. TV show wise, I loved Gotham. And that show on Netflix with Aziz Azale, Aziz.
And Master Ash vs. Evil Dead.
I didn't get to see it, though. I don't have Showtime. Or Stars. I don't have Stars.
Seen the pilot. I haven't seen the rest of
Master of None with Aziz on Netflix is a good show. And some of Fargo was good, but they fucked it up with that janky season finale
don't
episode.
No spoilers. I gotta see it. So.
Okay. Oh, you wanna spoil Star Wars, but we can't spoil Fargo for Mark.
Star Wars is out already, man.
So was that show.
Fargo, it's going to take me. I got to download it.
Man. Oh, you're an asshole, by the way.
I was waiting for the whole thing to finish, and it's done now. I gotta.
You guys have any favorite moments of 2015? Pop culture-wise?
When Jarrell threw my back out.
Oh, we cannot let that story go, can we?
Trying to pick you up and drag you to the train station.
I was drunk. It's not my fault.
And then my back was killing me for 2 weeks, and I happen to have a manual labor job where I lifted shit all day. Oh, it's great.
If you had a heavy penis like me, you wouldn't have that problem. I'm talking about best of. Talk about great things. That
happened.
Unless
sorry.
Nothing great happened to you this year.
I loved, I got engaged.
That was this year?
Fuck yeah.
I thought it was last year. I couldn't believe it.
April. Of 2015.
That's right. I emailed you April for May. Okay, yep. For getting Mark on the show was a good moment, too.
Start on this show.
Yeah.
got a new job. Said fuck it to my old one.
You must like Christmas more a lot now that you're out of there, right?
Yes. Although yes. I was disappointed this year because there's no goddamn fucking snow.
It's too hot here in New Jersey.
Gray clouds, gray everything, fog and bullshit.
Just wait, like next week, it's going to be freezing. You're going to be like, oh, fuck, I shouldn't have complained.
I
don't mind the
cold. I hate snow, though.
Yeah, I hate like snow as well.
It. Yeah.
You know, so like it's a double-edged sword. It's like, I want some snow for Christmas, just so that way I don't
feel. I don't care. I was happy.
I was, too. I fucking hate.
I was happy.
I hate anything under 50 degrees. Well, it's pissing me off, so.
Let's see, what else this year? What happened this year?
I mean, pop culture. Yeah, global
warming's making New Jersey a nicer place.
Yeah.
Everybody's going to want to move to New Jersey.
We'll get to the, any besides music, any good shows you guys watch? Because I know, you were saying the Muppet Show you like a lot.
Yeah, the Muppet Show and Ash vs. Evil Dad.
Ash vs. Evil Dad.
The Grinder.
The Grinder. Oh, yeah, you were talking about that. The Fred Savage at his best.
Shark Tank still going strong with the tank.
Yeah, I watched Shark Tank.
I hate that game,
I watch Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune.
Yeah, fuck does, yeah,
this is the year for Jeopardy? This is their year?
Yes, yes. This is your, oh, my God. Matt. Year. Robot Matt. I call him Robot Matt. Dude, no personality whatsoever. Just smile like a robot. He won like 13 episodes of Jeopardy in a row this year. And he almost got second highest ever on Jeopardy.
Ken Jennings.
Yeah.
I forgot about that guy. But, all right, so any movies you saw this year you liked, Mark?
I'm looking forward to a couple movies coming out soon.
Cheater. Oh, you're looking for the Batman vs. Superman, like me, right?
Is that coming out? No, there's this movie called The Lobster.
Everybody hates that movie.
That I want to see.
What's it about, cooking?
There's this guy seafood? That made these two movies from Greece called there's Dogtooth and Alps. He's made these two fucking really weird Greek movies. He's got this new movie coming out. That's his first American movie. Or I think it's out. It may have come out already in like art houses and shit, but it's going to be on DVD soon. But it's got Colin Farrell. And it's got John C. Reilly.
Amazing actor, Colin Farrell.
And so he goes to this like... Colin Farrell goes to this weird resort retreat thing where it's like men and women have to meet each other and they have to find a mate. If they don't find a mate by the end of this retreat because they're already so old, they get turned into an animal of their choice. And he chooses the lobster. So he's going to turn into a lobster by the end of the movie if he doesn't find a girl.
Okay.
So
you saw no good movies this year.
I haven't seen it yet.
Okay. Except for Star Wars. That's the best movie you saw.
Star Wars is the fucking shit.
Star Wars and The Grinder is his greatest moments and getting engaged. So let's get to the worst moments for me. I would say Donald Trump and all politics because it's way too early to be talking about that shit. And plus Donald Trump's pulling a lot of bullshit. Talking about Caitlyn Jenner is getting on my fucking nerves.
Did you see she wants to be a man again?
Like an actual frozen what, like thing in the store?
That's what the Weekly World News says.
Like a mannequin? Like just standing
no,
still?
No, not a mannequin. A man again.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh.
It was like Caitlyn Jenner says, I'm tired of being a woman. I want to be a man again. I want to be a mannequin now. Yeah, first the guy wants to be a girl.
Maybe he found out you don't get laid more.
Exactly, I wanted to stand still in stores. Did people close on me? You're saying mannequin. Like, you're saying it wrong. Yeah.
That's what they did do to him. They did turn him into a mannequin.
What do you think? I mean, that's like, it's a...
Nice one.
For as much of a... I understand there are people with legitimate, like, body issues. They have their... You know, that's...
I do. I certainly do.
Do you think that there's a point where, like, it's such a trend where there's going to be someone who's like, I want to be a woman, and then they become a woman, and they're like, oh, wait, I just kind of like their clothes. I also enjoyed having a penis.
Yeah. That's kind of like just like what Fat Mike from NoFX does. He cross dresses because it's cool.
Oh, okay.
Like I never actually wore dresses. I don't know how it feels on my body, but maybe it's more loose and fitting. It might be cool. I don't know.
Let's all try it for next year.
Yeah, next year resolution. We're gonna wear dresses from the shows.
Instead of a skirt, can I wear a kilt?
Yes.
But then that's man wear.
Yeah, I guess kilts and skirts are kind of the same though. But unless your balls,
you can wear a
like,
skirt and then tell everyone it's a kilt.
Yeah, it's just that's a hilarious. Scottish dress.
Yeah,
I don't know. Another thing I'm sick of in 2015 is the Hotline Bling song that was getting fucking annoying. So that's not gonna be on my list. The Drake song.
Oh yeah, huh? Fuck it.
What about No, I'm surprised it didn't make. Mark Ronson. Okay. Mark Ronson did not make your list.
That's a fair thing. Are you sick of that song?
Uptown Funk?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, you know what? Here's the thing is, right? I like having worked at the CD store.
Yeah.
Yeah, having heard it a million times.
But it's been, it's literally, it's only been 3 months, but it feels like it's been a lifetime from when I had to hear the same shit over and over and over again.
That song would come on all the time?
Doesn't fucking bother me. Yeah.
So
Don't believe me, just watch. We had like a fucking demo speaker. We had a speaker that would play that when everyone would come in and push it. So you push the button. Don't believe me, just watch. Boom. Every fucking day. Nonstop.
That's fair though. But Stu hated the song instantaneously. I thought it was a good song, but it's annoying. But
I knew what they were doing. They tried to sneak that funk into me, and I was like, they're faking the funk. They're faking it.
The thing is, I thought the song was good, but the reason I put Hotline Bling on, I instantly thought the song was repetitive and boring.
Yeah.
And now it's like, why is the song on all the fucking time?
I don't think I've heard it all the way through. Like, I don't think I've heard
it. You're
song.
A brave man. Even when they were like, oh, look at the meme where you're dancing with.
I've heard that. I've only heard... You call me on my cell phone.
Yeah.
Which I assume is probably just how the whole song is. So
that's all it is,
I probably have heard it in my brain.
I don't want a Hotline Bling.
I've never actually listened to it.
Lucky man.
There were other funny things on the Mark Ronson CD, though, so it wasn't that bad.
I expect to see it on your list.
It's not on my list.
Did not make top 10. Movie-wise, the two movies that I want to talk about that were the worst things I've seen of this year was Human Centipede 3, okay. Which...
A third one?
If you hate the second one, this one makes the second one great. Somehow they were able to make the third one even worse.
I can imagine it.
And
ew.
I want to get mad at Mark real quick because after the last show we did, we were walking home from where we record at Clenda's house, and he was saying, oh, man, I don't want to do your voice, but he was saying that Adam Sandler movie Pixels was a great movie. You should definitely see it, which unfortunately I couldn't do, but I was like, oh man, if he said that movie was great and he just recently released a new Hanukkah song, which was funny.
Oh, really?
He's on point now. So let me get this movie Ridiculous 6 a try.
No. You're going to fucking you're gonna put me on blast.
I'm going to put you on blast.
A movie that I did not endorse.
That was some shit, man. Ridiculous 6 was ridiculously horrible. And, I don't want to tell you the whole storyline because there's a twist in the movie that if you want to endure the movie, but I'll be fair with the movie. If you've seen the Seth MacFarlane movie, A Million Ways to Die in the West, this movie is better than that.
It's better than that?
It's better than that.
I actually like that movie,
though. Yeah, I thought that movie was pretty good.
It sucked to the beginning, and then it brought me back in.
When does that happen? Because I could not take it anymore after half an hour. When does he decide, you know what? It's been half an hour. I should start writing jokes
something
now.
Something about it, I like lowered my expectations watching the movie.
I couldn't get any lower.
Like, all right. Just accept it and move on. And I was like, all right, this is kind of enjoyable later. But, yeah, no.
God damn, you guys. I haven't had
a chance to watch Ridiculous 6 yet. But
watch it.
No, thank you.
When you give the rating, it immediately starts with people have already rated it a 1 star. You can't go any lower than that, apparently, on Netflix. I thought it was better than that, but still, I did not like it. I had to give it a 2.
All right, enough movies.
All right, you ready now?
Yeah.
You guys ready for some our top 10 lists?
Top 10!
I don't have music for that, but... We should have got Letterman to come in for that. We should have got Letterman himself for that.
Bing, 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 bing.
Are you guys actually ready for some Major Ska?
I'm not eating any more of that.
Major Ska?
You said
you're not eating any more of that.
That's how drunk he is. He doesn't even want to eat it.
I'm the only one who didn't get any water.
Pour me half a shot. Yeah, you got vodka every time?
That means you won.
Get on my level now. Seriously.
That means you won. You won, Mark. You won. Or lost. I don't know how it works.
No, I think that's lose because it's roulette. That means you got shot the most.
Nice. All right. So just be the two of us. Let's do it.
Everybody!
Okay. They always say women and children first. So, Mark, go ahead. This is Mark's top 10 albums of the year.
All right. Well,
let's do 10
for
1.
It's not very nice.
When I got here, I realized that I had left one out. Because it wasn't on my iTunes. So I reordered it. Now I have a top 11, but I'll just say I also have an honorable mention.
Which way are you going? You're going from 10 to 1.
Yeah, 10 to 1. So like all that.
Right, so we'll cross. So number 11, which is an honorable mention. I'll go through my honorable mentions.
Okay,
first.
Go ahead.
No.
Come on.
You have honorable mentions.
He did his homework. Extra credit, man. Extra credit.
This is all the stuff I put on my list and said, all right, this is what I have to pick from. And
fine. I'm not doing honorable mentions, though.
That's fair.
All right. Waves with V/5. I don't know how you pronounce it, but that was a pretty good one. That was my number 10 before I realized I left one out.
Okay.
Faith No More, Sol Invictus, Mike Kroll, Turkey, and Dune Rats with Dune Rats.
Dune Rats.
Those are all my honorable mentions.
So all these bands are basically indie rock. What would you classify each one of them?
Well, Faith No More is Faith No More.
Yeah.
Waves is like a lo-fi punk, pop punk band, I guess.
That explains his high review on the fucking Caged Elephant.
He likes lo-fi shit. Dune Rats is like an Australian punk band. They toured with another band that's on my list, Fiddlar.
Okay.
Anyway, number 10.
Number 10. We started.
Michael Cronin with MC3.
Who the fuck is that?
You should check these out.
Okay, that's what I'm saying.
He's like an indie rock guy. He's from San Francisco. There's a guy, Ty Siegel, that he's played with a lot.
Hey, Stu, before he goes on, did you want to get Mrs. S in here? Because she's going to explode.
Oh, okay.
If she's with the baby, she can't. But we'll let you know what you missed if you are going on. If you want to explain, the guy is from San Francisco, which I was at last year.
Yeah, he's
indie rock. He just sings by himself.
Michael Cronin. This is his third LP.
Is she busy?
His last album, I would put better than this one. MC2 was better, I'd say. But this one was pretty good. It's got some good songs. I just didn't like the fact that there's like... He sort of like went high concept with it. So there's like this song, but it's got like 5 parts to it. So whatever. Get over yourself a little bit.
Number nine.
Bodega Satellite with Trace. They're a local band. They're from Woodbridge, technically. They play around a lot. I've played with them a couple times. They've come to see my band, my former band. But they put out an album this year that's really good. Check it out.
And they sound like what?
Bandcamp. They're a Spanish, alternative, as if 90s alternative, but most of the lyrics are in Spanish. Not all of them. Sometimes they're in English, but he's a Spanish dude that sings. And so, check it out. Bandcamp. $6 right now. You can get all 3 of their albums.
Okay.
Number 8 is Waves and Cloud Nothings.
Wasn't Waves on your list already?
Yeah, they put out a full album of their own stuff, but then there was a collaboration that they recorded over like 2 weekends with the dude from Cloud Nothings.
Should we let that count, Stu? What? A collaboration album?
Yeah, why not?
Collaboration album?
Like what?
It's still an album.
It's music. It's
all right.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
I can put a fucking soundtrack on here. It's not like it didn't count.
Yeah, right. You can't put a single. I did have a lot. Yeah. There was a lot of singles that I could have picked.
No singles, no EPs.
It's the whole album. Yeah. They dropped it like without any warning. It's like the two of them, 2 weekends, they recorded like 10 songs and put it out.
All right.
Number 7 is Courtney Barnett with her album Sometimes I Sit and Think and Sometimes I Just Think. She's also an Australian
I like
chick.
The name of the album. That's fucking funny.
She, I started listening to her last year, and she put out, an EP that was really good. And this full length is, even better. Check it out. She's, I know she's nominated for a Grammy this year, because she's, Best New Artist or something.
I knew I didn't recognize that name.
Yeah.
That sounds familiar.
It's a really good album. Okay. Screaming Females, number 6.
I saw them. We saw them open for Bouncing Souls.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Rose Mountain. Fucking album.
Yeah.
I've been a fan of theirs for a while. They're from New Brunswick. I used to see them back in the day in basements.
I don't know if I bought that album, but I bought their album.
My cousin dates the drummer in that band, so I get to hang out with him at holidays and stuff for the most part.
Okay.
So I'm a little biased, but their album was really good.
They're a female singer. A female singer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, a female singer, and they're a grungy kind of L7 sounding band.
Grungy, lots of really good guitar solos. Number 5 is The Libertines with Anthems for Doomed Youth.
Is that the same band that sings that, hey, ho, I've been singing with them, but it's not them?
I don't think so.
Okay. Libertines.
The Libertines, they had 2 albums. One of the dudes in that band dated Amy Winehouse when she was alive.
And dead. Okay.
They have a history of heroin addiction, and they're kind of one of those bands that fell apart for a long time, and this was their big comeback album.
Right.
And I will say, did not disappoint. Really fucking good. Enjoyed it thoroughly. Number 4, Jeff the Brotherhood. their album Wasted on the Dream, which was supposed to be like their big major label debut, and then the label was like, we're not going to put this out. So they put it out themselves.
Okay.
And nice. It's fucking amazing. It's really good.
More indie or what does that sound?
Jeff the Brotherhood is two dudes. They're brothers. One of the guys was a guitar player in the band Be Your Own Pet in the early 2000s. And then when they broke up, he started Jeff the Brotherhood. It's two brothers, a guitar player and a bass or a drummer. And they play like really sweet fucking guitar based, like alternative rock. I don't know, man.
Okay.
That's all cool. I listen to is fucking...
Yeah, I'm getting a theme the here. Yeah. When's the R&B going to come in? I bet it's number two.
Hey, man, number one, with a bullet, fucking Chris Brown. Number three is Fiddlar. Their album Two is their second album. The first one was really fucking good. The second one, even better.
Okay.
Like, really... But this one is a little more produced. They started out really like grungy rock, punk rock, all about doing drugs. And this one's more about having gone to rehab. Now they're like, we need to fucking be a band instead of a party.
That's the best kind of music when it's about drug influenced music, yes.
Number two, Cage the Elephant, Tell Me I'm Pretty.
You're fucking kidding me, dude.
I fucking love that album.
You liked it that much better than everything you mentioned?
It made it up to two.
Wow, seriously. Dude.
Maybe I'm a little...
no wonder you looked at me like that glasses. When I was like, nah, you know, kind of boring.
He had his hand ready to do the Vader like choke.
Laser beams shooting out of his eyes.
Like I said, I'm a little biased because I like the band already. They probably would have made it on the top 10 regardless, but this album...
Yeah, but like
it really blew me away. Like once I got into it,
like I said before you get your number one, I said the same thing with Kid Cudi. I had him ready.
Yeah,
and you can't be like that, man. If it's bad, it's bad. Or if it's even okay,
but it's not bad.
It's not bad.
I fucking like it a lot. Like it's one of those things I'm gonna keep listening to.
I think what we should do,
I'll say the top six of mine from Screaming Females on is all albums that I've listened to like a bunch. Like I've had it in the CD player for weeks.
Okay,
and like. Cage the Elephant from like the last week when I was supposed to listen to it.
Yeah,
all week I've been listening to it. It's like won't leave my fucking.
So I think that's what he's saying, Stu. We got to listen to it 15 more times and we'll like it.
All right.
Number one, I've said it before and I'll say it again. Local H with Hey Killer, their
really
album that they put out this year.
Local H, apparently Local you guys H, listening out there. If you guys wait, if the people are millennials, like our news person Melissa, they have no idea who the fuck that is.
Yeah,
but people our age remember that band that sang that song "Bound to the Floor" and the Eddie Vedder song.
Yeah,
they're apparently still making new music.
25 years later, they made an album that is probably, in my opinion, I think it's better than most of the albums they've put out in the past.
Like guitarist my favorite, and drummer, right?
It's only a guitar player and a drummer, and they're fucking. It's actually this is the first album with a new drummer.
Mm-hmm.
They had it. He had not like you would notice, while, but okay. And he had another guy for a little while. New drummer, first album, and it's just like instead of the last two albums were kind of like theme albums, and there was like a storyline to them almost. This one is like straight up to the point rock. Fuck you, music. You know it's really good. So, and then let me just go on.
Go ahead.
Two things. I had two albums that were huge disappointments to me this year. Okay. I was looking forward
we were gonna
to.
Actually do a bottom five next year.
Okay.
But you can tell us now.
I'll say my big disappointments of the year were the new Bloodhound Gang record, Hard Off.
Yeah.
It's mostly just an album that of like shit that Jimmy Pop I guess did in his fucking house over the last 5 years, because they haven't put an album out in like 10 years or something.
Yeah.
This one finally comes out. It's garbage, mostly. Like it's almost all just terrible shit. Refused. Freedom. Refused is a band that...
They're still doing music? Like new stuff? Refused. Wow.
Fucking killed it with their one album, Shape of Punk to Come.
Yeah.
They broke up. They were like, we're fucking done. 20 years goes by. They come back out. I saw them the first reunion tour they did. They blew me away. Really great band. They were like, we're making new music. They kicked one of their guitar players out of the band. They put out this album, and it's a huge disappointment. Like, there's some songs on there, though, that I love, but overall... Like, get your shit together, man.
All right, cool. That was a good list. It was mostly indie music and rock stuff, but... Mrs. S., you want to have a comment on a Mark's list? Let her comment on each one.
I honestly don't know many of those bands, so I can't really say much.
Have you heard of Local H or Bloodhound Gang or the...
I obviously know the Bloodhound Gang.
Okay.
But I don't know local H. All
right. You, if you play that song, you'll know it. But
okay.
You know the song, yeah. You know the word copacetic? It's because you heard that song.
Okay.
So pathetic. All right. Next up on our top 10, 15 of albums of 2015 is Stewie.
Stewie.
Big League Stew.
Damn it.
With his top 10 of 2015.
I'll go with Fu Man Stew as well.
No, you're Big League Stew.
All right. Well, yes, hip hop made it in my top 10.
Yay!
Method Man, the Meth Lab.
Number 10?
Yes.
All right. Number 10 is Meth Lab.
Yes, yes.
Why'd you put that there? I thought when we did a review of that album, I thought you thought you were kind of like.
I did kind of go low, but I like it. It turned out I liked it.
So with that being an eh, I think you
and,
are
and,
you know, putting,
I picked,
like.
I picked from albums that we did review because I've been here all year.
Yeah,
reviewing albums. I mixed albums we did review with albums that I really liked. So I had to weigh.
Okay.
Between the two, because I mean, if I say I like something, you know,
I think that's
I can't
fair,
weigh that on something that I find that's a totally different genre
I think
or
next,
underground.
Next
or...
year, Mark's list will be all stuff we do reviews on.
Yeah. Oh, well, you did get one from that we reviewed, this week, which is kind of strange.
Two actually, because Faith No More. Faith No More
second,
was your honorable. Okay, never mind. Go ahead. Number nine.
I was going to say 11. I'm counting the wrong way. Number nine. Five Finger Death Punch. Got your six.
I like that album better than you did. You wanted a list? All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
I made a list.
I didn't know it was on your list. Okay.
Another one that we did was Zed.
Zed. That album was not good.
That's like dance music, right?
Yeah. Thought it was pretty good.
With like Selena Gomez and shit.
Fat Mike's Home Street Home.
Number
what?
10, 9, 8, 7. Fat Mike did a musical punk music.
Yeah, and he had a CD release of all the music that he did.
I saw like a documentary about him putting that all together.
Yeah, it's pretty good. The one they put on, I want to say Spin? Who does that shit? It's not Spin, it's someone else. I can't think of it. Noise, or some pitchfork, whatever.
Enough.
Sorry. Number six.
Number six. Nero, Between Two Worlds.
Nero,
very
that?
Female vocally album for them.
Is that like a metal band or
no? It's a electronic EDM.
Second guess.
EDM used to be like dub. They used to do more dubstep, but they're more trancey now. Then what would it be? Six, H2O, Use Your Voice.
It was not that good, dude.
That was a good album. It's good punk rock.
All right. You're just
and
under,
we reviewed it.
You're on their dick, dude. Just I mean, if you guys listening out there, H2O, I interviewed you. You guys are great guys, great band, but that album was just to me. But obviously I remember we did the review and Stu, you loved
it. Come on, you don't think they make top for 2015? Fine.
I don't want to judge you. I didn't judge Mark.
My phone shut
you.
Off.
Although you, I did judge
for
you,
all
this
crappy indie music.
You can judge me all you want.
You put Cage Elephant too high for me.
But. All right, this is where it starts. All right.
Number five.
No, number four.
Number four. What was number five?
Oh, number five was H2O.
Okay, number four. Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm getting my numbers mixed. I don't have numbers next to them, and I'm counting backwards, and I'm drunk.
That's what you tell the cops. Yeah.
Mord Fustang.
Love that name.
Yes. Mord Fustang. The name of the album's 9999 in 1, the Definitive Edition.
Okay. And that's another EDM band, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Number three, Zomboy Resurrected,
mm-hmm.
which is also like dubstep. EDM.
Dubstep.
It's
like Skrillex kind of, but better.
One we also reviewed, Mode Step.
Oh, yeah. That was actually good.
Mode Step, London Road, which is like, it's like dubstep EDM meets rock.
So basically, Mrs. S, if like I told you before, if you like Muse and you like dubstep, it's like them. Yeah.
It's like sort of a hodgepodge.
God, yes.
And number one, Feed Me.
Feed Me. You were talking about that shit all year, man.
Yeah.
Is that an album or an EP?
No, an artist, Feed Me.
No, I mean the album you're talking about.
Oh, no, it's an album.
What's it called?
A Giant Warrior Descends on Tokyo.
I like the name. All right.
What's that like? Feed Me.
Feed Me? It's like Fidget House. So it's like dubstep, but like it keeps like more of a constant rhythmic beat.
Okay.
Huh. All right. Pass the mic so S can give her opinion.
I don't really like EDM, so I don't really have much to say.
What about the
that.
Stuff she didn't?
But Zed really isn't that good, so I can comment on that because I know who Zed is.
It was low in the charts. It wasn't up there at the top.
But it's still in the top 10. That's no. sad.
And we reviewed it. He doesn't branch out very far, so I felt like he was reaching out.
No. Nah, we'll talk about
okay,
that next
No, okay, fine.
Year. But that's fine. If you like the album, which I'm feeling like you don't ever listen to, but that's fine. All right, now it's time for the big dog to give his top 10 of the year. So here we go.
Call yourself the big dog from now on.
Number 10, 21 Pilots with the album Blurry Face, which 21 Pilots is a singer, guitarist,
yeah.
bass player, keyboardist, and a drummer. And they put out their, I wouldn't say it's their third album or fourth,
it's
fifth
their
album.
Second album.
It could be they if it's only one person.
Two people.
Oh, it's two people.
It's two people, and they have a band that does like hip hop, rock, kind of like what Foster the People do, but rapping at the same time and
they're
dubstep
like weird,
here and there.
Yeah. From what I listened to when I used to work at that CD store, is like,
yeah.
they go from between like rapping stuff to like a little more like. Pop punky like stuff.
Yeah, that's what the whole album
confused
like. Yeah.
me.
And they have like pop music too. Like the song on this album called "Tear in My Heart" is a good song.
Yeah,
Blurry song. Face album has a song called "Stressed Out," talking about how we used to like be read to sleep, but now we're stressed out as adults. Really thought provoking music. And the first six tracks are amazing, and then it kind of gets like you gotta listen to it more and more. The follow-up album songs to like get into it, but if that's my number 10 album, you gotta know the rest of the albums are gonna be like fucking magnificent records. Number 9 is Doomtree album, which is called All Hands. Doomtree is a Minnesota rap group which has a female artist and five other MCs that have their own solo albums. And it's a great album as well. Listen to it. It's really like just like indie, like hip hop music, but like a lot of like break beats and shit like that. So, speaking of break, number 8 is Break Anchor album, which is called All Van Down by the River. And that album is the side project of the lead singer of the Suicide Machines. And I interviewed them this year, and they had them open. Members too, the Break Anchor open.
Yeah. Yep. I remember.
So I don't want to be like a. And this band basically
was
sounds.
Was there?
This band basically sounds like a cross between the Fugazi and the Bouncing Souls if they like meshed into one. So it's like very old school 90s, like a.
Fugaga Soul.
Indie hard. Not indie, but what's the word? Not indie, but like post hardcore.
Bouncing Gazis.
Yes, Bouncing Gazis.
What's that called?
They're called Break Anchor. And basically, like I said, it's like an old school, like a post-pop hardcore punk band. Check them out. Number 7, which is, actually the album has a 7 in their title, Lamb of God, 7: Sturm und Drang, Dungrun. Lamb of God is a, what would you say, they're kind of like a...
Metal.
But there's subgenres of metal. But this particular album, it's got the groove metal sound, which I didn't ever notice them doing before. Like, kind of like Pantera.
You know, he actually sings on it, right? Like, more than just...
Yeah. It's like, there's one track on there, I forget the name, but it's like Pantera, like, ballady. Mm-hmm. Like, when Pantera did that ballad song, you get this love. It's like that, but, like, the whole album is great. And they have that it's the lyric I love, remember, Stu, when they said, you're strung out like a marionette? Love that shit, man.
Triple Z snap.
Yeah. Number six, Lupe Fiasco's album, Tiesto and Youth. Lupe Fiasco is like kind of an alternative rapper, but in the mainstream at the same time. I see you looking, Sue. I see you
Why?
Looking.
Why? I'm not.
Don't look at my list.
I'm not looking at your list.
Lupe Fiasco's rapper. Got the Food and Liquor albums. I don't know where he's from, but he's got a, this album's great because it's very intricate with like different styles of music, and he's got like 8 minute cuts of songs. The second song on the album is an 8 minute song where him just doing fucking bars for 8 fucking minutes. And have you guys ever heard a song that was so good that you had to pause it because it was just too amazing? You had to take a break from it. It's just too great.
Yeah, actually.
Okay, so I thought it was crazy, but the song on this album.
Take a break. I've had to turn down songs because I was driving too fast.
Okay. Well, this song on the album is called Chopper. It's a posse cut. It's got like mad rappers on it, and they are angry when I say that. And it's like 9 minutes when the song kicks off. It's like kind of like got that like southern. Like a Atlanta sound.
Okay.
But like 2 minutes into it, like, that song's a fucking banger. Oh, shit. And then you look at the time, then you got 7 fucking minutes to go. Like, oh, shit, your heart's beating so fast. 5 minutes in, you're like, oh, I gotta take a break. You lay down, fucking get in the corner like a fucking boxer, like, hydrate yourself and go back in. The song is that great. I would have put it higher on, but I had listened to this album 2 times, like Mark said, to realize it's a masterpiece. Not a masterpiece, but a great album. Number five, Good Riddance, Peace in Our Time, which is a punk band from, what would you say, California? On Fat Records. And they have their album. They came back after 9 years to put out a new album. And this album is like a cross between the Vandals and Good Offspring.
Okay.
Like,
you like the Vandals?
You don't like the Vandals?
No, I don't like the Vandals.
You like the Vandals?
Yeah. And Offspring.
So if you like the Vandals and you like the Offspring, you're going to look at me like, oh, why should I listen to this? But I'm telling you, this is like some great music, man. So pick this up. So now we're after number five, we're getting to the albums that I liked instantaneously. I didn't have to let them grow on me.
Wait, I seen the vinyl, the Vandals with you.
I did. It was a very romantic moment.
Yeah. Well, I
talking about, like, you know, you want to hit that
Offspring? Was that when I was throwing up? Was that the romantic part?
Good Offspring. Like, I want to say, like, Smash. It's not as good as their first.
Hey.
It's not like the first album by Offspring, but it's like it's like that album. But if you take that and what the Vandals do, put it together, it's basically what Good Riddance do album sounds like. And it's just magnificent, like, fast skate punk.
Sweet.
And it's good to hear it back.
Like good Tony Hawk Pro Skater soundtrack. Yeah.
But they're fucking in their 40s and shit, and they're killing it. So it's like fast. Mm-hmm. Listen to a song called Dry Season, which is a single actually from this album, if you want to get an idea of how fast this shit is. Number four, Icky Blossoms.
Oh, I knew you were.
Oh, you forgot about that, didn't
you? No, I didn't forget about us, so I just passed them up.
Amazing band that opened for The Faint that we saw. And they're like a techno-y rock band. And their second album, which is this one we're talking about, is a great album as well. So they're on a trajectory of.
They got
great
some
music.
Gross graphic arts.
Yeah, and they have very what's the word epilepsy inducing like videos.
Yes, that you saw that as well.
You saw The Faint on this last tour?
No, we saw them 2012.
Oh, okay.
I remember texting you.
Terminal 5.
Terminal 5.
That's right. Yeah,
in New York. Yeah. So when we saw the Icky Blossoms open for them, I was like, my God, this is amazing. I got to buy their album. So I'm following this band. And we did their album this year, and it was a great review from both me and you, Stu. So I'm surprised it didn't make your list.
Yeah, it didn't make the list. Five Finger Death Punch pushed it out.
I was surprised you didn't put Slayer on yours over Five Finger Death Punch.
Slayer? Oh, I forgot they had an album in 2015. I didn't have much time to do this. Fetty Wap. Yeah. So
Or Game. Wap. Yeah.
I did like Fetty Wap better than the Game, so.
You did.
So, you know, Fetty Wap, number 11.
So make sure you send your hate mail to Stu, because he did actually say that on record, that he likes Fetty Wap better than the Game. Number three, 4 Years Strong, self-titled album, which is a easy core, which is a term now. Easy core.
You know what's funny is that I feel like I haven't heard of any of the bands that are on your
list. Isn't that a contradiction? Like yeah. Easy core.
It's easy core. Yeah. Really? Wait. Before we go on, really, you ever heard of 21 Pilots?
I heard of 21 Pilots, and I heard of Lupe Fiasco, and that's probably
and Icky Blossom, right?
No, I never heard of that.
Okay. And you ever heard of 4 Years Strong?
No.
Okay. Well, they're basically like what to Remember does.
Okay.
But
better.
You hate Day to Remember, but they don't scream as much as them. They're not as hardcore as them.
Okay.
But what is it? What it's not hardcore. What is Day to Remember? My wife likes Day to Remember. They're not hardcore. It's more like I want to say death metal, but something in between that. What is the
wouldn't that be
screaming? The
emo core?
They don't do that. Even though
emotional hardcore,
they're not remotely emo. No. Yeah, they're more pop punk, but this particular album is so raw. For 4 Years Strong, it's just like straight up all the old school shit they did in one album. Pick it up, self-titled is amazing. Number two. Which Stu had on his list, Home Street Home, the Fat Mike musical that he did with all the bands from Fat Records came together and did like a musical that they're working on, which is basically about a 16-year-old girl who was raped by her father and like runs away from home, meets all these gutter punks, and like forms a scene with them, and then the mom comes and I don't want to tell the whole story, but basically the musical's not even out yet, but when you listen to the whole album, you can put together how the musical will play out.
They haven't really the album, the musical.
They put out the demo. He's calling when you look read the liner notes. This is a demo of what the actual musical soundtrack will be. So, so he puts it out, and it's basically all the songs that will be on the album. But when you listen to the whole album, you will get an idea of how the story will play out. You'll listen to each song. You'll be like, "All right, this is how this is next thing that happens. Next thing that happens." Mm-hmm. Amazing record. I'm really proud of Fat Mike because there's only three moments in his career that he's impressed me, and this is one of the things he's done. That
what
I was
the
like,
other two? "I want to know the other two."
All right, number he did that 18-minute song okay. about like politics and shit, the longest punk song in history.
Okay,
not counting from the 70s, but I don't want to say that. He had that. That when he was against Bush in 2004, yeah. Rock against Bush and this.
Okay.
So I was like, "Wow, this is amazing! You did a really thought provoking, kind of like Rocky horror picture show esque like sound."
Mm-hmm.
Amazing record. I had it on my number two when I first heard it. It was that good. So pick it up. Number one. Here we go. Now, a lot of people will say that the new Adele album is, like, amazing. But I'm not one of those people. So my number one album is very predictable. Kendrick Lamar's To Pimp a Butterfly. And I know it's been nominated for 11 Grammys.
What was that? You gotta say that
Kendrick
again.
Lamar, To Pimp a Butterfly.
Okay.
Why is the album so great? First of all, It's brings back the old school like G-funk rap as well as the jazzy rap that's been done from like Tribe Called Quest. Very thought provoking social political lyrics about, you know, like black people in the hood and stuff like that don't know how to spend their money. With the song like Wesley's Theory, the first song, which is about Wesley Snipes. And then it's got songs, what's this one song I like? I Love Myself with the sample of, I want to say Temptation, I don't know. It's like an old school R&B thing that they sample. What's the, Stu, remember the song that, on the Paul Boutique song album? Where it's like, it's like Ad Rock MCA singer.
Oh, that's
A Year and a Day.
Disco Dave.
Disco Dave. It samples that, but I know it's a popular song. But they sample that in that popular song. But it's a whole album of basically tracks that are very thought-provoking and very, like, black-conscious music. A lot of people will say that album is very overhyped or whatever like that, but I think it's, if you listen, I listened to the album when it came out, and I'm like, this is really good. It's on my list. And I went back and listened to it again, read along the lyrics at the same time, and that's what makes the album so phenomenal. And I remember we did, like, a question from our emails, like, what would you consider, like, is a masterpiece? And I didn't have an album that came out in the past 10 years. Oh, my God, I can't breathe. But I'm going to have to call it right now and say that the new Kendrick Lamar album, which is not as good as his album before, Good Kid, Mad City, in my opinion, but similar to Red Hot Chili Peppers album, Blood Sugar Sex Magik, is not as good as Mother's Milk, in my opinion. But I feel like Blood Sugar Sex Magik is a masterpiece. This album right here, To Pimp a Butterfly, is Kendrick Lamar's masterpiece. It's an amazing record. It's definitely going to win a Grammy. If it doesn't win the best album of the year, if Taylor Swift or...
You care about those things?
I don't. You're right. If it doesn't, obviously... People don't know what the fuck they're talking about, but what makes me so happy about this record is that that's the kind of rap music I'm happy that exists, or if it comes back in the mainstream, him and Lupe Fiasco, like, the more thought-provoking, more experimenting with, like, different sounds and stuff, not so much, I like bitches, I like hoes, I like money, I like drugs. All right, that's the first song. I'll talk about that again in the next song. But this is, without a doubt, the greatest hip-hop album with... Nay, the greatest album of 2015.
Nay.
In fact, I will say this right now. We were driving, me and...
it is a dark time when you say nay to an old woman.
Nay! We were driving, me and the wife were driving to, or driving back from AC for our anniversary last year, or this year in September. I put this album on. She listened to the whole thing for the most part. And she said...
I said, but some of the lyrics I thought were funny. So I don't see how it's a masterpiece lyrically, but I'm sorry. I can stand listening to the whole album and I don't like that stuff, but I would never go and say this is the best CD of a year, so I'm sorry if you thought I was going to say something else.
We should have rehearsed this.
We gonna be alright.
What about the song This Dick Ain't For Free. You like that song. The jazzy
funny.
Song.
Yeah, it's funny.
I wouldn't take that song seriously. It's just funny. The way he said it, I thought was funny. And he does say that a lot. And I was like, what is happening? Anyway, I'm going to talk about Home Straight Home. Because I don't know what
Get it closer to her. She didn't hear.
Okay, because I don't know what you guys see in that album.
Go ahead.
Maybe it's because you guys don't listen to musical soundtracks, and there is, you know, rock musicals.
Before you answer that, wait, Mandy. Before you say it, I want to say right now, I hate musicals. I hate Grease, but this fucking musical turned me around.
Yes, but there is
That's
more.
That's why it made it so great.
But there yes, is more exactly.
Than
exactly.
Grease and all the stuff that everybody's exposed to. There's other musicals that not everybody's exposed to. That's Oh, they have, like, rock operas and whatever that are really
punk
good.
Punk rock operas.
That are really good. And maybe if you listened to Spring Awakening, because I love that so much, you would see that there is good rock musicals, and you would understand what's going on by listening to that as well. It's a story throughout the song.
So what did you hate about it, though? Could we listen to that on the way home, too?
I kind of think that because, I mean, he has his own record label. On the way there, right? He has his own record label. I feel like the production doesn't even sound that amazing. I felt like there was still a lot to be done with the song.
It's just a demo, though. It's just a demo. It's not like the full...
Okay, but you guys are still, like, both put it on your list, and it's not that great. Wouldn't you want to put something that is, like, the production's great and everything else on your top 10? That doesn't make sense.
No, we're talking about the structure
you're
of the songs.
But you just want to blow him, I feel like. You want to blow Fat Mike.
I might get his punk juices in me, and I can...
I don't think it's that. Again, I don't think he's that amazing, Fat Mike, but that's why you hate when I say those kind of things.
It hurts.
It hurts. Daggers.
Really? Isn't that great?
That's painful.
Okay. I'm actually holding my head down right now, you guys listening out there. I made my list, and she had the harshest criticism on it. And we're fucking married.
At least I put Fat Mike a little lower on the list than you did.
I should have did that. I should have put the band, the thing lower. But, oh man, if you guys want to give your opinion on our list, let us know in the comments, which we'll give at the end of the show, or give a thing in our email. We'd love to know what you think. What is your top 10 albums of the year? Or what do you think about what we said? Man, I feel like shit now. I thought she would actually like it, but she shut down my two. But all right, that's fine. I can't live another day. Stu, Marky.
She shot down your one, too.
Yeah, she shot down my one and two. You guys want to get some emails now?
Yeah.
Actually, we got to see if we have any emails. Let's go check the old computer and see what we got here.
Get a new computer. 56K.
Want some more shots? We snuck that behind Lil Jon. Easy, we did some shots. You didn't get to say it. It's fine. Let's see here. Let's check our emails here.
You've got mail.
Nice. Got some mail here.
We've got females.
All right.
Not all of us.
Burn. Burn yourself, man. All right, this first email, if I can read it, because I'm... had way too much to drink now. It's from Skrillex, DJ Skrillex. And he says, what's up, guys, and Melissa?
It's not actual DJ Skrillex.
Yes. Yeah, sorry, DJ Skittles.
Skittles.
Sorry, right, DJ thank Skittles.
You. Thank you. I was going to say, what the fuck?
Are we that big? Dad, damn. Zed's emailing us. All right, so DJ Skittles says, what's up, guys, and Melissa? Nice show last week. Drell, you kind of fucked up with giving Coldplay a buy this review. You need to take a walk on that, bruh. Clear your head for the next podcast. I think my head's clear now, but it's very full of alcohol at the same time. Sorry about that. I think it's clear now. I hope you like my reviews now. Anyway, just had a quick question. With Christmas coming up, I'm assuming you all celebrate it. If any of you are Jewish or whatever, I apologize. What Christmas gift do you want? Did you want so badly, but when you got it, you instantly didn't want it anymore? For me, when I was 8 years old, I wanted a skateboard so badly because all my friends skated. So my parents or Santa got it for me. That afternoon, I went out on my driveway, took one step on the board. It immediately rolled out from under my feet. I flew back and hit my head. I hit the back of my head on the bumper of my dad's 1988 Toyota Cressida.
Very, very coordinated person here.
So for Christmas night, I spent it in the hospital getting 10 stitches in the back of my head, along with having horrible scrapes on my elbows. Needless to say, I never skated again, and that skateboard remained in my garage collecting dust and cobwebs until I took it to the junkyard 15 years later.
Dude's miserable. He could have sold them trucks.
Sorry for the long email. Hope to hear.
He could have took the trucks off and sold the trucks. The deck's probably worth nothing.
He says, sorry for the long email. Hope to hear some good stories from the crew. Peace.
The crew. DJ Skittles. now he's part of our crew.
Yeah, DJ Skittles.
All right.
Or he's speaking to us as a crew.
Yeah, I think he means that. We're the crew. Yeah. which is a song from the
Sporting Anti-Swastika Tattoos.
Yeah. No Effects, baby. All
right. I think she's right. You want to suck the fucking.
If I haven't already.
Fat cock.
Fat Mike's fat cock. That sucks, man. If you fucking bust your head. I never got stitches before. Have you guys?
Yeah, I have.
Did it hurt?
No, what? Stitches don't hurt. The getting cut hurts. Yeah.
The reason you have the stitches is the hurting part.
So sewing your head is okay, like a needle in and out.
They put fucking anesthesia on it.
Like, oh, they do.
Yeah. It feels kind of good. It pulls things together.
Oh, it looks like awful.
I've never busted my head open, but I've had stitches before.
I've split my leg open, my knee open.
He asked if I ever
cut my finger open.
The only time I had a gift that I didn't want, I had it. Two times, actually. One, I actually asked for a shark attack. You remember that game? Shark attack. This shark is like a maniac.
Remember you were sold by the commercial. Yeah, I can clearly tell.
Yes.
The kids' commercials in the 80s and 90s? Yeah. Late 80s and 90s? Oh, my God.
I was so catchy.
Sold on that.
So catchy.
Crossfire.
Oh, yeah.
Crossfire!
Yeah, everyone had that.
Like when I saw that fucking shark, because I love animation. That shark like chasing the guy, and he jumped, and the shark would eat his boat. I was drawing. I'm like, I gotta get that, and I forgot to realize I'm an only child, so I have no one to play it with. So when I got it for Christmas, I'm like, yay! I open it, and it's like, all right, I have nothing to play with. So I actually lost the shark. I took it out and played with my other like toys, and I don't know where it went. It's kind of the same thing as the game I bought, Domino Rally, because I like the dominoes thing. I had the first one. I built it, knocked down, loved it. And then it had the second one, the glow-in-the-dark thing. Mm-hmm. Bought that, set it up, and I got kind of... It was so complicated, I didn't bother finishing the whole thing. And that's in my parents' basement, both Domino Rallies. But it's kind of like stupid. Like Mrs. S told me the same thing. It's like, she's like, I don't get the thing of dominoes. I'm like, you just set the shit up, and... Knock it over. It's fucking awesome. You just make picking things up
it's
and making
like watching a train move. Yeah. It's like watching a model train go.
You put things together and you knock it down. The end. It's like, God damn, that's kind of stupid. Go all that work and it's over in like a minute. If that. And the other thing I bought, I didn't buy, but my parents got me was, it's my mom's fault for that, but I was all about Game Genie.
Oh, yeah.
Which is a Nintendo thing.
Ruins all your games.
You can basically plug it into your Nintendo cartridge, put it in your console, and it would tell you how to win a level or whatever.
No, you could cheat. You could put different cheats in.
So my mom would
hold extra lives.
Yeah, my mom saw that.
Invincibility.
I put on my list. My mom was like, "You just want to cheat in games. You shouldn't cheat in games. That's wrong."
Yeah, but there's Nintendo purposely made games that were so hard that were impossible to actually play that you had to have Game Genie to beat them.
And
feel accomplished.
I got that thing. I finally got it for Christmas, and she put that in my head so much, I never opened it because I felt so guilty.
You felt guilty,
and that she said that, and then she eventually returned it to Toys R Us for me.
Oh, that's stupid. Game Genie was fun.
It was fun?
Game Genie was tons of fun.
She made me feel like such an asshole, wanting a Game Genie.
Game Genie was fun.
But that's my...
Yeah, I mean, even the stupid things you could do, you could make Super Mario, like, float backwards. He'd be like, you jump in the air and he'd just be floating in the air backwards.
If she had any idea...
It's stupid shit. Yeah.
If she had any idea that the internet would exist now, you could just go online and type it in. But that was the times back in the 90s. You couldn't do that. Yeah. So what about you, Mark? What was your gift that you asked for didn't want it when
there
it came?
It was August. It was before school started.
What year is this?
This is 1994, maybe.
Good year.
Going into like fourth grade.
Yeah.
Power Rangers. It's all the fucking rage.
Oh,
See,
I was after the Power Rangers.
You can tell me and Stu are too old for that. Yeah. I feel so bad because Mark is so close to our age. We just missed
it. Power Rangers. Yeah, I just missed Power Rangers.
Yeah.
Well,
we were in high school and we're like, this is stupid.
Yeah. Well,
when it first came out,
like fourth grade.
Yeah.
Power Rangers. So they all had their own Megazords, or they had their own Zords. They were these robotic animal things that they would become.
Yeah.
But then they, there was a time when they needed to really defeat the fucking monster or whatever. They would combine them together like Transformers.
Or Voltron, yeah.
The Megazord.
Yeah.
So it was like, this one was the arm, this other guy was the fucking other arm, this one was the leg, the two legs, whatever. So they had that as a as its own thing. And I was like, I want this, Mom.
I See, well, I had Voltron that did the same exact thing. Voltron, we had Voltron.
Like but I wanted it. It was a special edition. It was at KB Toys. And it was a special edition one. And I was like, Mom, I want this. And she's like, you're not going to get it. Like, your birthday is like 2 months away. And then Christmas, I'm going to make it your birthday and your Christmas present. If you really want this that bad.
Yeah,
you're gonna give up your birthday and your Christmas present this year.
Wait, when's your birthday close?
My birthday's in October.
That's not close, is it?
No, October. It was this was August. This was like before school started.
That's bullshit.
And it was like she's like October coming up is gonna be your fucking. This is will be your present for that and Christmas in another 4 months. This will be your present for that too.
Okay.
And she stuck with it.
Right.
I mean, maybe I had a couple stocking stuffers, some socks and underwear, but that's about it for that year for Christmas. Because I got the fucking Megazord.
Yeah.
The other thing I didn't bargain for was that it was the special edition Megazord, which now when the box shows that it's black and gold, it's black and gold. It's not like red for this one. So they're all just black and gold. Not like they're on the show. On the show, they're all different colors. There's fucking a red one. There's a blue one. There's a green. Nobody wants to play with the black and gold Megazord. They think it's fucking weird that you got this weird one. I fucking hated it. I gave it to my Polish cousins that came here from Poland. And I was like, you guys can have this fucking
Did you
thing.
At least smile when you opened it? Or were you just like...
Oh, yeah, of course. Okay.
You have etiquette for Christmas.
I wanted it real bad. And then I was like, this is... Nobody wants this. This is, this is not the right present. I didn't realize that everyone was going to think I was an idiot for getting the black and gold one.
Because I was like, thanks for my gifts. And I really had to feign like interest. Because I asked for it, like you said, with yours. And it's like, oh, when they turn their heads, it's like, shit. That's it. What do? I let it collect dust and see where it goes from there. So what about you, Steve? What was the gift you asked for that you regretted?
Oh, man. I got a Super Nintendo.
What? How would you be mad about that?
I got a Super Nintendo, and it was one controller and no game.
Why would you turn the whole thing away? Just get a game.
What are you supposed to do with a Super Nintendo with no games?
Buy a game?
Didn't even Eventually. Took Eventually, my Christmas money and bought a game.
Okay, so...
But it was a very disappointing Christmas gift because I couldn't do anything with it.
They used to do that for the Super Nintendo? Because even Nintendo came
Super,
with a game.
It was Super Nintendo with one controller and no game.
They probably were trying to make a bet that, like, well, they'll buy another game. We don't have to include it with this.
Yeah.
Fucking wrong move, Nintendo.
Because everything else, even Sega
I guess
Genesis
my mom didn't know. She was like, oh, there's supposed to be games with it?
Yeah, because even Atari, all that shit came with
a game.
They're
not in it.
Yeah. That's not her fault. That's just she didn't know.
Yeah, no.
So what, did you say something like when you opened it?
Yeah, I said there's no game. And she's like, well, you're going to have to use Christmas money and buy a game. I'm like, ah. Fuck!
I can see that at the Stu household. Like you open it, there's no game. I was like, no game. Well, fuck you! You gotta buy your own game. Who's next? All right. So thanks, DJ Skittles. That was a great question. Next one is from David Goldsmith, who is the. From the New York hardcore punk band, I can't read what is their band called? I remember they emailed us before.
Enziguri,
and we were supposed to interview them before, and we didn't get around to it. But we'll see what happens.
Maybe we can get an actual pronunciation.
Yeah, he says, "Hey Jarrell, sorry it took so long to get back to you because I emailed him earlier." Things been pretty hectic on my end. Our band is taking a bit of a break until the beginning of the year.
Heard that before.
After we record enough songs for our debut album, we'll start touring again. Hope to see you at one of the shows. Here's a question for you. What do you guys think of them opening CBGB's at a restaurant at Newark Airport? I think it's fucking retarded, but I love to hear your insight.
Would they would have music from back of the day?
actually
be playing in a restaurant, and it would be CBGBs. Can you imagine that? Like blast beats playing while you're trying to eat.
Actually, gonna check what that's going on with that.
Yeah, I've seen this.
CBGBs to reopen as an airport restaurant. The current owner of CBGB's name has announced plans to relaunch the iconic rep venue as an airport restaurant. The restaurant will be in Newark Airport, which is where we are, or close to us.
We're in the Newark Airport.
That's our closest international airport.
And featuring things such as $9 deviled eggs and $14 cheeseburgers. The establishment will be called...
Why did they tell you that? Basically, they're telling you to not go there. We will charge you $9 for an egg, which costs like 10 cents.
It'll be called CBGB's LAB, Lounge and Bar. The current owner of CBGB's name appears to be the holding company. There is no word on whether the new company will be... will keep the bathroom authentic to the original venue. I'm going to have to agree with you on this one, Dave. This is kind of a disgrace to the name, but the thing I can't really, it's not like the owner is doing it himself. It's someone else. It's just calling it that, right?
This is what I got to say to fucking Dave goddamn Goldberg, whatever the fuck your name is.
Goldsmith, sorry.
Shut the fuck up. CBGB's... does not exist anymore. It's a fucking name brand that is used to sell fucking t-shirts and give to the fucking tourists. Who cares? Unless you're going on a flight, this doesn't affect you. It's not like it's in the old space and now it's a restaurant. Who cares, man? Come on.
Ooh.
CBGB's Dave. I went to CBGB's and it was fucking bullshit. So who cares? Like, sure, it was a place that started lots of good music.
They couldn't keep it going.
They didn't keep it going. Like, the last fucking 10 years of it being open was bullshit. Like, who cares? It didn't mean anything to go to CBGB's anymore.
Court Tavern's still there. Stone Pony's still there.
Yeah.
Pump the brakes, Mark. Uh-huh. You went to CBGB's because me and Stu have not been there.
Yeah.
And you said it was bullshit your first time. Even though you never went there before when it was at its prime.
Friends, bands
I've been there a few
there.
Times.
You weren't there at its prime because you didn't exist at the time.
No, exactly.
Yeah. No, so you still said it was bullshit? So why would you say that?
No, there's a point. There's a part that's like, this means something because the Ramones.
Just
because,
bands that started. No, it's because it's New York City.
But
it's better. It's better than
everywhere
else. It
doesn't exist anymore.
If it's New York City.
Like Hilly, the fucking guy who started it, sold it. End of story. Like, now you're fucking... the thing that you think is so fucking important, this name of CBGB's, is being used to fucking sell t-shirts, sell burgers. Who gives a fuck, man? Like, what are you going to be the protector of the CBGB's name? Does it mean that much to you? Like, I could start a fucking another band called Coney Island, or another venue. Like, I'll start a restaurant called Coney Island High. And we'll be like...
No. There is a venue, Coney Island High.
That's what I'm saying.
Coney Island High, too.
Oh, all right.
I'm saying it's an old... Max's Kansas City.
I've been to Coney Island High many times.
That's what I'm saying. Is like... So
but
what?
I think what he's saying is, doesn't the disgrace the name to sell cheeseburgers and like
disgrace
eggs
what
at
name?
That much?
They've already disgraced the name. That's what I'm saying. It doesn't matter. Like, they fucking sell t-shirts to tourists in the fucking I Heart New York stores that say you can get I Heart New York, then you can get CBGB's. On St. Mark's, they're fucking selling $50 t-shirts of fucking the Ramones. You know, like, who fucking cares? It's done. It's over. It's like 40 years ago.
Yeah, but you, like, let me ask you this. Like, you're from New Jersey, and you love the Birch Hill. If they did the exact same thing at Birch Hill, you'd be mad as shit, right?
I give a fuck.
You wouldn't?
The Birch Hill doesn't exist anymore. All of a sudden, someone is like, oh, we bought that property. Let's make a restaurant called the Birch Hill. Yeah. It's like, great. I fucking saw Goldfinger there.
Me too.
Congratulations. Like, done. Over.
I played there before.
Look at that. See?
Yeah.
Got personal history.
Birch Hill
there.
Stingrays.
Okay.
There were. It was like
I never
a connection.
Of,
there was like two
I never
of them
thought
that
about
connected.
It that way. You're
Birch
saying,
Hill and Stingrays. They
you're
like
saying,
work together.
You're saying do what you want with the legacy. Yeah. I don't give a shit.
I'm saying it wasn't working. The fucking venue was done.
They
needed money and they sold it and that's business and fuck who cares? Like now they're making money off the name.
Before we go to Stu, what was wrong with the venue when you went? What year was that before you go on?
Yeah, but the Police played there. The Police played at CBGB's.
Yeah. Fucking replacements. He's like, yeah. Replacements. You know,
so you were mad when you went to see it? I've never been there. I think it's amazing to be at that venue.
Lots of people played a lot of venues.
Yeah, I never been there.
The Pyramid Club, Nirvana played there once. They Might Be Giants played there.
You saw whoever in 2004, and you were like, this is like boring. I don't like this venue. Is that what you said, or
no? It's at that point. I mean, I was there for a couple shows. That one was like a sold out secret show for the band Mindless Self Indulgence.
They're definitely mindless.
And another one was for a fucking, you know, it was like a Wednesday night. Some band that I was friends with was playing, and there was nobody else there. And I hung out in, like, you know, you're like, okay, well, this is the historic venue, and it's like, all right, you guys like can't clean up your fucking toilets still.
That's the point. Why are you not getting it, Mark? Is that the point of the venue?
What I'm saying is that. Yeah, but the point of it is over. Like, the venue doesn't even exist anymore. It's an art gallery or whatever. It's non-existent.
You're not done.
So somebody still owns the copyright on the name. Uh-huh. They can do whatever the fuck they want with it. Here's what I'm saying.
Go ahead.
That even someone who owns the name to something that you give a shit about and wants to do something with that name that you don't agree with doesn't mean that they can't do whatever the fuck they want to do with it. Because if I owned the name to CBGB's, I'd be making as much money as fucking possible off of it.
Yeah, but you can agree you don't.
Dude, how much money would that have cost for them to just keep it going? Why didn't they just fucking keep it going? Why didn't they just have somebody else run it?
Because it's not sustainable. Like, if it worked, if it was a viable business option, they wouldn't have to sell it in the first place. Because the name alone should be enough to keep it going, but it wasn't.
I mean, people go there to fucking drink beers and fucking.
No, they go to see punk bands. Crap
shows.
You go to see the Korn. You go to see Korn play at CBGB's.
No, Korn is not going to play at CBGB's. Did they play there?
Yes.
Really? There's not enough room.
That's the point. That's what's awesome about it.
If CBGB's, as a music venue, made money, they wouldn't have closed in the first place.
He can't have a shot. He's driving.
I'm not fucking drinking anymore.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. But yeah, no, I mean, whatever, man. Like, you're going to go to fucking Newark Airport one day, and you're going to be like, oh yeah, I remember hearing about that. And walk past
it. I don't know. It's like, I can't do it. Like, for me, I want to answer your question, Dave. For me, I've never been to CBGB's. I know the legacy of the place. It's great. If I'm going to fly out Newark Airport many times in my lifetime. If I go there and I see that shit, I'm going to be like, that's bullshit. I'm not eating there. I'm not drinking there. It's bullshit. I want to eat at the... If they open the actual venue and sold the same fucking burgers and shit at the same price, I would fucking be in a heartbeat there in a second. Just to be like, I'm here.
I liked Coney Island High better.
I just want to be like, yeah, I've been to
CBGB. You said Coney Island High. I liked Coney Island High better.
Marcus
and fucking... You don't see Coney Island High t-shirts.
Exactly.
Mark is downplaying the shit that he's been to CBGB's. Just like my father, I asked him, like, he's like, oh, I've been to, like, a Studio 54. And I'm like, really? And he's like, yeah, I was walking by there. And they said, oh, you want to come in? And they let me in. I'm like, you're just fucking being like a dick about that.
It's
a fucking big deal. You've been to that place.
It's a big deal because people have made it a big deal.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. That's the point. The Wetlands is gone. How many good bands played at the fucking Wetlands? Yeah. The Wetlands is gone. There's no Wetlands t-shirts. Nobody knows what the fucking Wetlands is. Yeah, nobody.
People do that for your place too, man.
City Gardens is.
We're not talking.
That's New Jersey. I was talking New York. You want to talk to New Jersey? Nobody gives a shit.
We're talking about a global scale. Like, it's a big deal to say, like, yeah, I went to Studio 54. Yeah, it's a big deal. I've been to CBGB's. It's a big deal. I was at the World Trade Center at the top floor, and then I left. And then the fucking plane is crashing. Place. It's a big deal. You're like, oh, it's whatever. No big deal. It's like, it's a big deal. You were there. It's gone. It's not going to be there again. So you're going to be like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah, but here's the thing, though. I wasn't there in the 70s when fucking Blondie was playing, and I can be like, I saw Blondie before anyone. Like, I was there seeing a fucking shitty band from Jersey City that no one gives a fuck about and doesn't exist anymore.
But you had no idea that venue was closing. You had no idea at the time.
No.
That this place will not exist anymore.
And I was
anymore.
Like, this is where it all happened, huh? Disappointing because it's just a fucking shitty bar that nobody goes to.
We all know that all the punk rock spots they're all fucking dives.
It doesn't matter. Like, this is what it is.
Yeah, don't make it so grandeur. Yeah, yeah.
All right. Well, I guess you guys are gonna attack me now, but I think
Woodstock.
I think what Dave is saying, it is fucking ridiculous. They're going to make it a corporate thing.
Dude,
but
2 years ago, I was at the fucking Metropolitan Museum of Art, and they had an exhibit of, like, the fucking art of punk rock. And they had a recreation of the CBGB's toilets. And they had fucking leather jackets on display, like, as if they were fucking art that you should... And it's like, enough, man. Because, like... Once those people start, because that's the whole thing, is it's supposed to be for us, not for fucking other shit fucking people.
That's the point.
And I understand that.
Yeah.
But it's over. Like, you got to admit defeat and move on. Because CBGB's is done. It doesn't exist anymore. The venue is not there. You can go into the same place that it was, and it will not be the same fucking bar stool that fucking Marky Ramone puked on or something. Whatever the story would be. You know, it's over. Get over it. It's done.
No!
That's just me being snarky.
We love you, Snarky. All right, so I guess we have to. I think I see your view on it, Mark. I agree with you. In a way.
When people are like nostalgic for shit that like doesn't matter, like that, like CBGB's, like it was a place that existed. You'll read all about it in your fucking punk history books, but it doesn't exist anymore. If someone wants to start something. Just let it, like I stopped being angry about the fucking fact that they want to remake every goddamn movie that I saw when I was a kid. You know, there's a new Ghostbusters movie coming out.
Right.
I'm going to see it and just see what it's like because I stopped caring that they want to do all this shit. You know, like, you can only be angry for so long. Why be angry?
Yeah. I think what Mark is saying is you can be like a Lewis Black, or you can realize that you're old. And the thing that you love so dearly are the young... The youth are going to find and take it away from you.
Yeah, did you do anything to save CBGBs? Probably not. So, like, where the fuck were you? That's what I'm going to say.
What can one man do?
Exactly.
All right.
Bigger than all of us. And it's the way of the world. Everything fucking changes.
Wow, that's so depressing, dude.
Welcome to 2016.
We're going to get into 2016 right now. So, if you have anything to email us, any questions, comments, or whatever, like, so to speak, email us at njhabitradio@gmail.com with your questions and things like that.
Yeah, not to be harsh, we love the emails. Yeah, so
that was a good debate, man. Mark fucking like turned the tables.
Either way, no matter what we say, we still love you for emailing
us. Yeah, keep emailing us.
Let Mark tell you what your piece of shit you are.
I'm going to tell you you're fucking wrong. That's what I'm going to say.
Let it go. So, let's get in, before we get out of here, I want to say the plans for the website for 2016.
Oh, God, that means me.
Yes. One of the things that I see what's going great about our website is for the past year, we got the interviews.
Do we have to talk about this on the podcast?
You don't want to say that? All right, we can end the show. I just want to say I want to congratulate you for doing a good job, Stu.
Oh, all right.
But
I only look at what's wrong and what needs to be done.
I want to say what you're doing. You're doing a good job.
Oh, all right. Thank you.
Because honestly, from the time we started, where I had to force you to listen to the album reviews to now, you're doing a good job with.
Well, I
being
still
prepared
listen to
them
last
stuff.
Minute.
It's still.
Whoops.
Yeah, you're still. I think you're doing a good job.
All right. Thank you.
I like what you're doing. And I think if people want to ask what's going on for the future, Mark, I'm hoping we can have you on for more shows. And if you want to give your insight on what you want us to review for 2016, give your input, both of you.
And
or even
Melissa.
Yeah. If you have ideas of things that are coming out in the new year, because I don't want to be the one like the embargoing all the things we pick, you know?
I'll have to like look at what's actually supposed to be coming out because I never keep track of that kind of stuff. It's
okay.
Just kind of like, oh, this came out? Sweet. Let me check it out.
Because I always feel like I'm like when I pick things, I think you guys think I like it. And I really, not all
that's,
the time do.
That's
but
why I like the show. Doing the show is because it makes me listen to stuff that I wouldn't normally listen to. Now, most of it I think is garbage, but I wouldn't know it's actually garbage unless I'm willing to give everything a fair shot.
Okay, I want to change that, like where it's more 50-50, where stuff you like or are interested in and stuff you hate and despise. Both of you, Stu, and even Melissa, who I feel like Melissa's more like open-minded, being a girl and young and all.
You always bring up the young thing.
She's a millennial. She's a kid.
All right.
One of the things we're going to do different, we're going to have more.
She could drink. She doesn't drink.
She doesn't, but she can. We're going to have more video. We're going to have video reviews coming up next year. Video reviews. So you can see a video of what we're doing. We're going to keep the interviews going with like the popular bands. Because we did the interview with Suicide Machines. Suicide Silence, right?
Yes, yeah. Suicide Silence.
Bouncing Souls was great. But I want to get more interviews with like different genres of music. Like you guys said, Gas House Gorillaz.
Gas House Gorillaz, you definitely should have interviewed.
Yeah, we'll try to work on that. So if you guys want to let us know bands that are coming around.
They're playing in Pennsylvania if you'd like to see them.
I like to see them in New Jersey. So more bands.
Well, they're playing in Pennsylvania, next state over.
You want to let us know bands that we should be interviewing or albums we should be reviewing. You can let us know that as well. What else should we do with the sites, too? What do you think we should do? What needs to be worked on?
I know what needs to be worked on, but, you know, now's not the time.
Marky, what do you work think? On it. What do you see the site?
Input.
Being a new person to the site.
I already
site.
Know everything that needs to be done.
I want to see what this awesome t-shirt is.
T-shirt. The awesome t-shirt. Yeah, that's more of a joke than anything.
See, I think what we should do with the merchandising is...
If you're going to pay $35 for a t-shirt, it better be fucking awesome.
Yeah, so we're going to have more merchandising for you guys in the future, but we don't have a date for that. And also, I know you guys are telling me in the emails that we got to put the radio stations up. And that is definitely coming in the beginning of the year.
Somebody sent an email about that?
Yeah, a couple of emails ago. They're like, where's the radio stations that I see? That is definitely coming. We have radio stations. We have video reviews, all that stuff coming. So I want to say on behalf of myself and the two of you, you guys did a great job. And I'm looking forward to next year. Mark, it's really good to have you on the show. Even from back when we did the Faith No More review to now, your insight is fucking phenomenal. And I knew you were going to be a good job from back when we worked together at the store. Your opinion is not for movies, but definitely music. You're very cynical. And I love that. And that's what I'm going to do for next year. Because I feel like myself, with not so much for Coldplay, with everything else, I feel like I'm being too fair with reviews. I gotta be more angry. I gotta be more spiteful for what comes out. I gotta be more critical, right? I'm too positive.
It's all shit.
Yeah.
And then if it surprises you, that surprises you.
Okay, I'll do that from now on. It's just look at this guy taking phone calls in the show.
It's Steve Hoffer. He's on our podcast.
Steve Hoffer.
Yeah.
Tell him you'll call him right back because I know him. We had lunch together.
You had lunch together recently?
It was in high school.
Hi, Steve.
Say, remember Jarrell Stowe?
You remember Jarrell Stowe?
Mayo and fries.
Mayo and fries.
Face to face. Green Day.
Face to face. Green Day. Why are you having me repeat shit? But yes, it. We're doing a podcast right now, and my phone rang.
We'll call you right back, Tom.
Yeah, I'll call you right back. All right, I'll call you back. I'm going to be smoking a cigarette in like 10 minutes.
It's sucking my dick.
Late.
All right, so yeah. So that's basically what's going on with the website. I think we went pretty long, 2.5 hours. You're doing freaking good. Let's end the show right now.
Yeah.
Anything else you guys want to say?
Nope.
All right, great.
Fucking legalize it.
All right, so if you want to get in touch with us, go to our website, njhyperradio.net. Yes, njhyperradio.net. Or go to our email at njhyperradio@gmail.com. Or you can go to our YouTube, check out our videos and everything like that at youtube.com/njhyperradio. Where else can they reach us to?
Wait, yeah.
That's pretty much it, right?
Yeah. The usual. You don't have to go through everything this time.
This has been a great year.
They'll figure it out.
We will be back January 24th. January 24th will be our next podcast. We'll have new reviews from Megadeth, Panic at the Disco and an old school California melodic hardcore band called Ignite. Love them.
Woo!
And from that point on, we'll have more insight on albums to review going on from there. From Mark and Melissa, who hopefully will be back by then. Until then, this has been Jarrell and Big League Stu.
Yep.
And Snarky Mark.
That's me.
Saying goodbye and Happy New Year!